The next item of business is a debate on motion 15048 in the name of Shona Robison on fiscal sustainability, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Shona Robison to speak to and move the motion up to 15 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate comes at a timely moment as we await the first budget of the new UK Government tomorrow. All eyes will be on the Chancellor as she sets out the steps she will take to address the economic and fiscal challenges ahead and whether these will be sufficient to properly tackle fiscal sustainability. The Scottish Government has been clear on its expectations, and I'm reiterating these calls on the UK Government today. However, I'm also clear that we need to take action here in Scotland over the short, medium and longer term, and it's vital that all members of this chamber have the opportunity to engage in this debate. The challenges we face are significant, systemic and will stretch well beyond this parliamentary term. In the immediate term, the latest medium-term financial strategy was clear that we face a significant and growing gap between funding and spending, as are the other devolved nations. We took difficult steps just last month to deliver further necessary savings to reach a balanced position in 2024-25, of course something we have done every year for 17 years that we've been in government. As we look ahead over the longer term, we will face broader strategic challenges. In March last year, the Scottish Fiscal Commission published its report on the Scottish Government's long-term fiscal sustainability. I'm very grateful for the work of the SFC. By bringing independent forecasts, insight and analysis to the Scottish Parliament, they play an important role in ensuring the public finances are fiscally sustainable. Through a combination of low birth rates and a rapidly ageing population, Scotland's demographic outlook is likely to change significantly over the coming decades. The population of Scotland is expected to fall by approximately 400,000 over the next 50 years, driven by the low birth rate. Recent birth rates in Scotland have been historically low and are assumed to remain at this level for the next 50 years. These changes in the age structure have implications for the demand for public services, with more demand for services used more by older people, such as health, and less demand for those used by younger people, such as education. There are now also more deaths than births each year in Scotland, and the gap is expected to get wider each year. This reduced labour supply has a direct impact on our nation's productivity and, through reduced tax revenues and lower economic growth, on our fiscal sustainability. So the implications of this are stark under the devolution settlement. As the Fraser of Allender Institute has noted, the increased spending on public services will run ahead of the likely increases in the funding available to the Scottish Government, including the block grant and devolved revenues. But these challenges are not unique. All four nations face the challenges of an ageing population and declining productivity. I hope that members would accept that while some of the tools to address these challenges sit with the Scottish Government, not all do. In this context, it should also be noted that there is some positive data regarding migration into Scotland. The latest figures from the National Records of Scotland show that in the year to mid-2023, Scotland's population rose faster than at any time since the 1940s. The main driver of population growth over the year was people moving to Scotland from abroad and other parts of, the UK, with inward migration highest for young adults. This demonstrates how control over migration policy could work to improve the fiscal outlook in the medium to longer term. Give away.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. And I think it's absolutely right that in the short term we have to look about net inward migration. But in the longer term, global population growth is slowing and will meet an inflection point in the 2080s, i.e. this is going to be a global race for talent, and actually we need to think about how we deal with that from a skills policy, not just an inward migration point. Would you agree with that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I would, and I'll come on to that in terms of what I think we need to do in terms of the bringing all of that together into to one place to look at that collectively across all the parts of government, because you can't look at this in one part of government. I'll come on to that shortly. Presiding Officer, with the powers we do have. We have already taken meaningful steps in order to improve the financial outlook. We've made difficult choices on spending for the budget in 24-25, and we've taken further steps as the year has progressed, including those announced in the recent fiscal statement and other measures that we've had to take. Increased additional scrutiny has also been applied to expenditure via emergency controls. Through our emergency controls and savings announced, we will, of course, seek to minimise the use of Scotland in 24-25 to achieve a balanced budget, because we recognise the importance of that for investment. We've also improved sustainability through our tax choices and estimate that our income tax policy choices will raise an additional £1.5 billion in 24-25. Yep, we will announce our tax policy decisions, of course, during the annual budget process. Yes, Lou Smith.
Cabinet Secretary is quite right in saying that she's had to employ emergency decisions that have had to be taken. Does she now regret the fact that this debate didn't take place much earlier when the Finance Committee had asked for it over a year ago?
Cabinet Secretary.
Made any difference to the fact that emergency controls had to be brought because of the additional pressures of pay, because of the UK government accepting the pay review body recommendations, adding another £800 million of pressure for this year of 24-25. So we couldn't wait to take action for this financial year by having a debate about the long-term financial sustainability, whenever that was, would not impact on the decisions we had to make in year. Those decisions had to be made, difficult though they were. But actions in the short term will not be enough. The Scottish Government has already taken decisions to improve the financial sustainability through the MTFS and has set out the areas that need to be tackled over the medium term. And these include demand-led challenges in health and social care as a result of an ageing population, pressures on public sector pay and workforce, and social security expenditure. And that's why we have put in place a three-pillar strategy which focuses efforts on addressing the drivers of public spending growth, taking a strategic approach to taxation, and increasing tax revenues by delivering economic growth. On public spending, Audit Scotland noted in their report last October that significant reform to the public sector workforce will be needed to ensure fiscal sustainability whilst protecting frontline services. I'm also clear that our public sector workforce will need to change size and shape. Members will be aware of the emergency spending controls that we've enacted this year, including a freeze on recruitment. And I'll set out more detail on our approach to the public sector workforce in the 2025-26 budget. Alongside the budget, I will also publish our tax strategy, which will set out our ambitions for the tax system over the medium term, providing strategic direction on the role of tax in supporting the delivery of our government priorities in a fiscally sustainable way. The strategy will also outline how the economic priorities set out in the programme for government will support growth in the tax base and revenues. Boosting economic growth remains a top priority for this government. We'll continue to support businesses and increase productivity in order to achieve national prosperity with a strong green well-being economy and indeed to attract that global talent that was mentioned earlier on. But I want to go further. And today I want to announce the government's intention to publish a five-year sustainability delivery plan in 2025. This document will set out the Scottish Government's plan to achieve and deliver sustainable public finances within the overall approach set out in the MTFS. It will bring together and present in one place the action the Government is taking to put the public finances on an ever more sustainable path. This is work which, of course, has been going on for some time in areas such as workforce, on pay, on public service reform, on growing the population and on economic growth. And we'll bring together these various strands into one central document to give further clarity and transparency to this work. And the delivery plan will build on the opportunity we have with the upcoming UK spending review to move to a multi-year approach, and will support a future Scottish Government spending review. So I look forward to engaging with Parliament on the delivery plan, and we'd be happy to discuss further with members across the chamber in due course. However, Our actions will only go so far, and as I said earlier, many levers continue to sit with the UK Government. I've already referred to migration. Scotland's distinct demographic and economic needs require a tailored approach to migration. Scotland needs access to international talent and skills at all levels of the economy, including within our tourism and hospitality sectors, to name just two. Scottish ministers are committed to working closely with the UK Government in delivering an immigration system that supports the prosperity of Scotland's economy and communities. Furthermore, it's simply a statement of fact that the vast majority of revenue-raising powers, from taxation to borrowing, are not available for the Scottish Government to explore. And this, of course, significantly limits our options for funding capital spending projects and makes the goal of achieving greater fiscal sustainability that much harder. As the First Minister set out last week, part of the solution to our sustainability challenges must come from the UK Government committing to increased public sector investment. Greater investment would improve productivity, which in turn will both support our public services to run more efficiently and generate more revenue from taxation. Sustainability must also come from stability. Our public finances will be more sustainable if they are predictable, so that we can plan on a reasonable medium-term basis. Shifting the dialogue from considering the future Scotland's public finances on a routine year-by-year basis rather than to the medium to long term will therefore need a greater level of financial certainty from the UK Government. In advance of the outcome of the UK budget and spending review for 24-25 and 25-26, there is considerable uncertainty on the level of block grant the Scottish Government will receive. It's also unclear how UK funding decisions for 24-25 will feed through into 25-26. And this uncertainty only contributes to the challenges facing the Scottish Government on our path to fiscal sustainability. And that's why we've called on the UK Government to set out three-year spending plans to allow the devolved administrations to invest with certainty over the funding position. And I do welcome the Chancellor's intention to move to multi-year spending reviews. And if they follow through on this in tomorrow's UK budget and a spending review in the spring, then the conditions may be in place for the Scottish Government to perform a spending review next year, and I'll update Parliament on this at an appropriate point. We understand that the Chancellor also intends to revise the UK Government's fiscal rules, and with this in mind, I repeat our call for the UK Government to immediately grant the Scottish Government increased capital alongside further borrowing and investment powers commensurate to those in the rest of the UK. That will allow for greater investment to review and enhance public infrastructure and deliver projects that support the transition to net zero. Alongside greater funding certainty, devolved governments also require greater fiscal flexibility in order to manage and respond to changes in circumstances. So I'll continue to work with my counterparts in Wales and Northern Ireland and with the Chief Secretary of the Treasury to secure changes that strengthen devolved financial management powers. As previously noted in this chamber, I'll be presenting the Scottish Budget on the 4th of December, and I've been clear that this will be a challenging budget. Unless we receive increased capital borrowing powers or a higher level of funding from the new UK Government, the Scottish Government will have to continue to make tough decisions to reprioritise our infrastructure projects pipeline to ensure we spend within our means. And in terms of modernising public services and public service reform, that capital investment, particularly in areas like digital, cannot be overestimated of their importance for transformation. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government recognises the significant challenges facing the medium and long-term sustainability of Scotland's public finances. Fiscal sustainability will continue to be an integral focus of the Scottish Government and will act as the bedrock to achieving the First Minister's key priorities of eradicating child poverty and improving our public services, raising living standards by growing the economy, tackling the climate emergency through infrastructure delivery. We don't deny for a moment the scale of the challenges that we face. We therefore ask for cross-party collaboration in addressing these as far as possible, both between the Scottish Government and other members in this chamber, and also between Holyrood and Westminster. So, in the spirit of that consensus, in which I hope will be a constructive debate this afternoon, I urge all members to support the motion today, and I move the motion in my name. Thanks.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Michael Mana to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. A generous 6 minutes, Mr Mana.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I am pleased to have the opportunity to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee today in my role as Deputy Convener, as what is part of a very important debate on fiscal sustainability, an issue of very long-standing interest to the Committee. Indeed, it was a key recommendation of our pre-budget scrutiny last year, was for the Scottish Government to schedule this very debate. We felt that there needed to be a constructive discussion about the fiscal impact of demographic challenges projected by the Scottish Fiscal Commission in its first fiscal sustainability report published in March of last year. Given the magnitude of the challenges ahead, we felt it was important for the Parliament to debate those ideas from across the political divide and how we should respond to these long-term issues in an honest and constructive way. After all, any political party could be governing the 50-year horizon of the Scottish Fiscal Commission's projections. We note that the motion lodged for today, however, appears to unfortunately limit some of that ability to build consensus. I hope that the debate rises above it. Indeed, the political approach that it signals could be said to be illustrative of part of the problem itself. The Scottish Fiscal Commission projected that Scotland's population is expected to fall by roughly 400,000 over the next 50 years, driven principally by a low birth rate. The number of people aged 65 and over is projected to increase from 22% in 26-27 to 31% by 2072-73. In contrast, the size of both the working age and under 16 populations are projected to fall. These changes to the population structure have wide-ranging impacts. The size of the productive tax base needed to grow the economy and pay for public services shrinks. At the same time, demand for public services among a growing elderly population increases. Additional pressures on health services are not offset by fewer young people, reducing the demand for school education. Spending on new Scottish Social Security payments, which do not receive funding through the block grant adjustment, such as the Scottish Child Payment, is expected to increase from £600 million in 2027-28 to £1 billion 50 years later, based on current policies. Continuing with these different policy choices means that funding must be found from elsewhere in the Scottish budget, from other portfolio areas. The Scottish Fiscal Commission also highlighted that if public services in Scotland are to continue to be delivered today, to be delivered as they are today, Scottish Government spending over the next 50 years will exceed the estimated funding available by an average of 1.7% a year, the equivalent of a £1.5 billion in today's prices. To address this funding gap, the Scottish Government would, the Scottish Fiscal Commission suggested, have to consistently reduce or raise devolved, reduce spending or raise devolved taxes through the next 50 years. In responding to the report, the Scottish Government said that its work on public sector reform, service reform, is a key element in ensuring fiscal sustainability and that public services are appropriate to support the needs of Scotland's changing population. It also pointed to the launch of a talent attraction and migration service and a new Addressing Depopulation Action Plan, and I quote, with a focus on resilience for local communities. It said it will continue to press the UK Government to put in place immigration reforms to meet Scotland's needs, as laid out by the Cabinet Secretary. The committee would certainly appreciate an update on those two schemes in the closing remarks and as the debate progresses. So the SFC report was invaluable in informing our pre-budget scrutiny last year. It continues to inform much of the work that the committee does on the sustainability of public finances in Scotland. It gives us a longer-term perspective to much of that committee work. Last year, as part of our pre-budget scrutiny, we sought to establish how the Scottish Government balances its short and long-term financial planning and to identify any improvements in this area. The evidence we gathered from businesses, academics, the public and voluntary sectors, think tanks and local governments suggested that the Scottish Government is not carrying out enough strategic long-term financial planning, and it appears to be firefighting on a number of fronts, and that there is little evidence to suggest a shift away from a short-term approach to financial planning. The committee notes from the Scottish Government motion that it does plan to publish a five-year fiscal sustainable delivery plan. The Cabinet Secretary has said a little more about that, but I would ask that she certainly engage with the committee to understand the scope of what that delivery plan will contain and how it differs, crucially, from the five-year medium-term financial strategy, given that the MTFS is, according to the Budget Process Review Group, I quote, intended to provide a means of of focusing on the longer-term sustainability of Scotland's public finances. Gladly.
Cabinet Secretary.
I will set out in a lot more detail, but I think in short order, what I mean is to go from the horizon MTFS looks at to the how. So the delivery plan will be the how change is going to happen, bringing all of that from across government into one place that will provide clarity and transparency about the progress of delivery against those objectives set out in MTFS.
Michael Murray.
And it'll certainly be welcome to see those details from the government as and how those apply to its broader policy agenda. I did mention earlier that public service reform is seen by the Scottish Government as a key element of that fiscal sustainability. That's recognised. But in the latest update to the Committee on its reform programme, the government recognised that public services are under considerable financial pressure right now, and if nothing changes, public services will become unsustainable in the longer term. It went on to confirm that there's a pressing requirement for reform to ensure fiscal sustainability. Any update that we can have in terms of the progress on those public service reforms, it would be gladly welcome as well. So in September, we heard from Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics at the University of Stirling, when he said that we shouldn't waste a crisis. Looking ahead 50 years can be challenging when there are immediate pressures to deal with, but it is vital that we find it within our politics for that honest debate about how we put Scotland's finances and its public services on a more sustainable footing in the longer term. That is essential. If Scotland is to meet the fiscal challenges projected by the SFC, it is essential if we are to break out of a cycle of emergency budgets and fiscal chaos. I look forward to the contributions from across the chamber on what is a very important debate.
Thank you, Mr. Mara. Before calling the next speaker, I would just encourage all members who are wishing to participate in the debate to check they've pressed the request to speak buttons. And I now call on Craig Hoy to speak to and move Amendment 15048.2 around 11 minutes. Mr. Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There is a ticking time bomb at the heart of Scotland's finances. In fact, there are four: the tax system, public sector pay, the Scottish welfare system, and the parlous state of the Scottish economy. And that's without mentioning the well-documented demographic challenges outlined already by the Minister. And if we don't act soon, these four bombs could blow Scotland's public finances apart and shatter any hope of achieving fiscal sustainability. As our amendment makes clear, a significant change in political direction is now required to deliver sustainability in Scotland's public finances. And it is clear to everyone and every commentator, except some of those MSPs who live in the Holyrood bubble, that sustained economic growth is essential for future financial sustainability. And that is why we are deeply concerned that the SNP has failed to deliver the growth and the pro-business policies that would drive it needed to achieve this now and into the future. I will just make some progress and then come back to you in a moment. But if they had done that, the Minister this year alone would have had £600 million additional revenues to spend to tackle some of the challenges that she said. But sadly, the SNP, time and time again, has adopted a cross-your-fingers and hope-for-the-best approach to the public finances. But now, as a result of the Scottish Government's budget and the medium-term fiscal position, we can see that both of those are unravelling before the Minister's eyes. And the Government has been repeatedly warned to change course, warned to change course by the Auditor General for Scotland, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, by the Fraser Valander Institute, by the City of London Corporation and many other groups, including repeatedly by my colleagues here on the Scottish Conservative benches. But ministers have simply ignored some simple truths. You cannot increase tax on medium and high earners and expect no behavioural change. You cannot deliver on ambitious net zero policies without setting aside the billions required to pay for them. You cannot grow the Scottish economy if you increase regulation or if you turn off the taps abruptly on North Sea oil and gas. You cannot dramatically expand the footprint of the welfare state without finding the sustainable tax revenues to pay for it. And you cannot expand the public sector workforce and increase its pay in real terms without fundamentally reforming working practices. And I give way to Michelle Thompson.
Michelle Thompson.
Thank you very much for giving way. And in some respects, him carrying on has added weight to my point. I wondered what he thought of Mark Logan's statement today, and I quote, "I fear the Conservative Party is at risk of becoming a bad episode of The Walking Dead, where members are aimlessly shuffling around with no purpose except to attack any signs of life that might come past them." That very Mark Logan, chief entrepreneur that the Conservative Party had a hand in getting rid of.
Craig Hoy, and I can give you the time back.
I think I think if you could see the response of the front bench there, they would realise that they dealt with that with the same level of disregard that I did, because fundamentally we're here to talk about people's jobs, people's livelihoods, people's mortgages, and not to throw around cheap insults. Now, fiscal sustainability is inextricably linked to fiscal responsibility. But all too often the SNP talks about how it wants to spend money, not how it will raise it or save it. It talks about how to raise tax, but not simplify it. And I have yet to hear an SNP minister talk credibly of the case for cutting tax in Scotland today. The SNP repeatedly puts barriers to investment in the way of business, rather than deregulating the landscape in which business needs to operate. At its heart, the government's motion today pays only lip service to the need for public sector reform and how it will deliver sustainable growth. It reveals that the government would rather talk about short-term fixes and increasing borrowing capacity rather than talking about long-term strategic and structural reforms. Only a few weeks ago, Shona Robertson came to this parliament to reluctantly reveal a near £1 billion in-year budget black hole. But I'd like to remind the Cabinet Secretary what she said in her May 2023 medium-term financial strategy. She said, "I am setting out how this government will maintain a sustainable financial position over the medium term," and she said she would be open and honest with the public. But if she was serious about maintaining sustainable finances, how on earth did she find herself back in this very same parliament to reveal such a large in-year overspend? Why did the government neglect to publish a clear public sector pay policy last year? Why did the Cabinet Secretary allow assumptions to be made for a certain rise in public sector pay, when in the end she signed up to a far higher inflation-busting increase? Why did the Minister not realise that by agreeing a settlement of that scale, she was, in effect, setting fire to her own budget, and not only has she done this for this year, she is doing it for future years when there will be no Scotland coffers to raise, Minister? Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to delve deeper into tax, because this could well be one of the dividing lines in the months and years ahead. On the future of Scottish tax, we could do worse than look back to the reforming Chancellor Nigel Lawson, because he didn't just cut tax, he simplified tax. And I agree with Kenny Gibson. Does Scotland really need six tax bans? Only yesterday, my colleague Russell Findlay opened up discussion on the removal of the 21 pence rate, and I welcome this discussion. Britain under Nigel Lawson had just two bans. His approach was simple and efficient. Now, the SNP like to compare Scotland to other nations around the world, so let's do that. Estonia, a flat rate of 20%. No, not at the moment. Ireland, just two tax bans, 20% and 40%. Now, I accept there are countries where tax bans are more complex, but that is often where tax is lowest. Singapore has 13 tax bans, but the top rate of tax is only 24% and only paid on earnings over $1 million Singapore dollars. It is clear there are significant savings to be achieved by making tax simpler, but ministers, of course, might not want to do that. Just one second, because a simplified tax system is also a transparent one, and the smoke and mirrors are removed. And reducing tax over time would reduce the administrative burden on both our governments and on HMRC. And it's basic economics that if we reduce tax over time, we still could increase the tax take over time. And I give way.
I'd encourage members to press their intervention buttons and call Daniel Johnson.
Noted, Deputy Presiding Officer. The problem with what Mr. Hoy has just set out is not just invoking countries with simpler tax systems, he's invoking countries with lower tax bases. And if he's going to do that, what area of the public sector is he seeking to cut? Is it social security or is it health?
Big Hoy.
Well, I think when you see year-on-year increases in the social security budget, which accompany a reduction in the number of people available for work, we have to question when the Scotland and the UK have seen significant increase in those on health-related benefits post-COVID, but not a similar rise in other equivalent nations. We have to question what are the underlying causes, and I would put it to the Scottish Government that their inability over 17 years to deal with chronic disease and their inability to bring down NHS waiting lists will surely be part of a factor for people moving away from being available as part of the labour force and now on long-term disability benefits. And that is something that is busting the Scottish Government's budget over time. And turning to welfare, the SNP has made political virtue of the way it's used devolved powers over benefits to meet political goals. That is a decision by the government. But as was referenced earlier, the government is now spending £1 billion, or will soon be spending £1 billion more on social security than Barnett consequentials allow for. Now, the minister dresses this up in the language of investment, and perhaps she could ask this question. If it is an investment, what return is she seeing on it economically?
Cabinet Secretary.
In the Scottish child payment is less children in poverty and those children growing up into poverty and their life chances being dented. If that's a political objective, I support it 100%. Is Craig Hoy saying he would cut the Scottish child payment?
Craig Hoy.
No, what I'm saying is we would grow the economy to such a position, therefore those benefits through time would not be as necessary as they are now. And we have to ask this question. Why, in real terms, has child poverty not fallen over the 17 years that the SNP has been in government? No, I won't, because the SNP aren't learning the lessons. They are committing billions to the consequences of poverty, but not to the causes. And they simply now have to find a way of re-engaging those many people who are now no longer active in the labour market in Scotland. And the SNP's decision to slash the budgets on employability, on addiction services and affordable housing will ultimately undermine efforts to grow the economy. We now need a strategy to boost productivity, to drive wage growth, to increase skills and labour market participation. And in short, through time, as best we can, to get many people off benefits and back into work. But there is, Deputy Presiding Officer, one area that I'd like to explore before... No, I won't. I'm short of time. Before I close. When we talk of the public sector in Scotland, the Scottish Government wants us to think of nurses and teachers, not the army of overly superannuated spin doctors. Only this week we found out that the number of staff employed by the Scottish Government has almost doubled in the past decade. Public sector pay now absorbs more than half of the entire Scottish budget. And by boasting that it will avoid strikes at pretty much all costs, the SNP has now given the public sector unions the whip hand in future negotiations. And we are now today, in my view, way beyond the point of asking whether the size of the public sector workforce in Scotland is truly fiscally sustainable. Scotland has more public sector workers per head of the population than the rest of the UK. On average, they are paid more than £2,000 more than their UK counterparts. And even if the Scottish Government receives significant Barnett consequentials as a result of public sector pay rises in England in tomorrow's budget, the Scottish Government will still... No, I don't have time. The Scottish Government will still face a significant funding shortfall because of the structure of the public sector in Scotland. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Conservatives will welcome a credible medium-term fiscal strategy to achieve long-term fiscal sustainability. But we have serious doubts about the SNP's capacity to deliver it. As the Finance Committee has made clear, this government talks in terms of long-term planning, but is all too often distracted by having to fight short-term fires it itself has ignited. Simplifying tax, boosting growth, overhauling public sector delivery, and reversing the rise in welfare spending will not be easy. Making Scotland a better and simpler place to do business should be a non-negotiable. But to avoid Scotland's finances crashing to the ground in years to come, the government now has to rise to the challenge of changing the engine whilst the aircraft is in flight. And however difficult this may be, the SNP must now firmly take control and take the necessary action to urgently deliver widespread structural reform. Only by doing this will the government be able to deliver the long-term financial sustainability which is so urgently needed by the Scottish public, by Scottish business and by Scottish public services. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Hoy. Just an encouragement to the front benches to follow the impeccable lead of the back benches in pressing their intervention buttons when they're seeking to make an intervention. With that, I call Daniel Johnson to speak to and move Amendment 150.48.1, around 9 minutes. Mr Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Maybe I just don't like my name flashing up in lights at the front of the chamber, but there we go. So far, this has already been an interesting debate. But if I may, let me just contrast, I think, both the approach that we've had from the government with that we've just had from the Conservative benches, because I think it's instructive. Because I have to say, I was somewhat fearful when I saw the government motion that they wouldn't actually address the fundamental issues. There are some deep-seated, long-term, structural and strategic issues that we have to face up to. And yet, I think the issue that we have from the government is marrying that up with day-to-day decision-making and the medium-term context within which many policies are being made. And I think we have to address that, and I don't think we heard enough from the government today. And indeed, I have to say, I agree with Mr. Marr. I am somewhat confused as to what a new five-year fiscal strategy looks like, given that much of what that should have dealt with should have been contained in the medium-term financial strategy. In other words, what is the point of a strategy that doesn't tell you what to do? But I think it contrasts a great deal with what we've just heard from Mr. Hoy, who failed to deal with those strategic issues whatsoever. It was all about the short-term tax rates. And indeed, I think the mask has somewhat slipped. Ruth Davidson's Conservatives have left, well and truly left the building. Some sort of Christian democratic social conservatism has been replaced by something which wants to replace our income tax rate with a single rate of 20%, with undoubtedly the slashing of the public sector that would ensue, without the honesty of saying so. No, indeed, you didn't have the honesty to follow through the implications of your own assumptions, because I think we need a bit of honesty. But whereas I do think he is correct that we have to look at the consequences of policies that are being formed and whether they fit within the fiscal envelope that we have in front of us. And after all, I think, without going any further, I think we do have to thank the Fiscal Commission, without whom I don't think this debate would be possible at all. It is without doubt, in my mind, that they are making an extremely valuable contribution to our public discourse and debate, not just with their fiscal forecast, which I think gave us a level of clarity, a common baseline that we can all discuss, but I think in their work, with their three reports on fiscal sustainability, I think they have done us a huge, I think given us a huge deal to work with. And let me just follow through on those long-term issues before going through, I think, both those medium-term points, but actually critically, I think some shortcomings in the way that the government has translated these issues into day-to-day decision-making. I think the Cabinet Secretary was absolutely right to highlight demography. The fact that our population will fall by 400,000 over the next 50 years will have profound consequences. What I would challenge her, though, is that I think we need to go into a lot more detail about what that means for day-to-day life, the economy and public services. This isn't just about the impacts on the health service, though profound though they are. This is actually about what does this mean for the workforce. I think we need to think about how we actually retain knowledge and skills beyond retirement age, which is not to say that we somehow want to delay retirement, but we will reach a point where we cannot simply afford to lose those skills and those economic contributions from the economy. I think that requires a degree of profound thinking, and we need to do so urgently. And be under no doubt, this is not just us in Scotland, nor just us in Europe facing these demographic changes. It is global. The world population is predicted to start falling from the 2080s onwards. The thought that we will be able to import talent to replace people who are moving beyond working age will simply cease to be sustainable, and in quite short order, within the coming two or three decades. But we also do need to think about climate change. We have a significant coastline that we need to protect. There are also opportunities from climate change. We are protected from some of the real ravages of climate change that people who live closer to the equator will have, as well as renewables opportunity. Both of those insights have to form an essential part of our fiscal strategy going forward. And above all else, and I'm sorry no other speakers have raised it so far, technology change is going to have a massive disruptive effect into our patterns of work, how we organise the economy, but most critically, how we deliver public services. But in the medium term, we have to look at the fact that the health budget has now reached 40% of our public expenditure and is forecast by the Fiscal Commission to rise to the 2070s. And let me be clear, I'm making this from the standpoint that our health service is absolutely fundamental to the civilised society that we all seek to have in Scotland. But we cannot do that. We are not being honest with ourselves if we don't face up to the fact that an ageing population will put huge and ongoing pressures upon it. And on a similar note, we have to look at the commitments we have made through Social Security. The fact that there is a shortfall in the money received through block grant adjustments and the expenditure committed to with our Social Security plans of some £400 million, just short of that, rising to £694 million in 2028-29, simply has to be addressed. Where will that money come from? Or how will those policies be designed to reduce that bill? We've got one of two options. And if it's the former, where is that going to come from? The health budget looks unlikely based on the other dynamics. Education budget? You wouldn't want to. Or is it through policy design? Do we need to rethink our social security to ensure that welfare genuinely is a hand up, not just a hand out? I think we're going to have to confront some of these very challenging issues. Otherwise, social security will, and it's one point where I would agree with Mr Hoy, become unsustainable. And let's be clear, it would be the cruelest promise of all to make promises of this sort only to have to withdraw them for future generations. That would be cruel and it would be unjust. But in the short term, I'm happy to give way.
Ben McPherson.
Thank Mr Johnson for taking that intervention. In those considerations, does he agree with me that it's important for Parliament to remember and recognise that most of those on disability benefits are getting those benefits in a way that is not means tested, and that's because of their disability? And most of a large amount of those who are getting income related benefits are getting them while still being in work through the universal credit system. So we need to look at this in a holistic way.
Daniel Johnson.
We absolutely need to look at it in the round, and we need to also look at it in the round of the economy, because we need to ensure that as many people can enter the workforce as possible, and we need to make sure that our welfare systems are absolutely supporting people in the way that they need to be, such as disability benefit, but we're also actually working in a complementary way with the economy. So we're maximising the talents of our people, maximising their opportunities. And I think we need to have a fundamental think about what that means and making sure that our social security policies are sustainable. But in the short term, we need to have a very serious look at how our finances are being managed. The fact that actually it's become an annual occurrence that we have an emergency budget revision cannot be sustainable, to use the language of this debate. The reality is that the resource spending available to the Scottish Government increased by 1% in real terms. It's now at a level very approximately of what it was during COVID. And yet you wouldn't know that to listen to the Government, because year after year they are mismanaging the public finances. Just in a moment, if you can answer this point, because it's critical to this, and the Cabinet Secretary alluded to public sector pay. But the reason the Scottish Government had an issue was because they had baked the same 2% assumption that the Conservative Government had. That's an absolutely scandalous position for the Government to have found itself in. And whereas absolutely we should be upholding the decisions of the pay review bodies, because that is how you have good workforce relations.
Cabinet Secretary.
With that in principle, but the UK Government then has to fund the pay deals recommended by the UK pay review bodies rather than part fund them, which is one of the issues. But I wanted to come back to the point about the gap in funding. The Chancellor laid bare the reason for that, that the 2021 spending review financial outlook was never reset to take account of inflation, removing £15 billion from public services, whether that's in Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, or in the UK more generally. That's where the shortfall comes from. It's in affected Wales with emergency budgets, Northern Ireland having to do a claim for a reserve 2 years in a row. But surely Daniel Johnson can recognise that point.
Daniel Johnson, I give you the time back.
Having to make the emergency adjustments of the scale that the Scottish Government had. And it also flies in the face that, secondly, the Scottish Government has had more generous allocations because of the Barnett formula, and that funding, total funding this year was £52.5 billion as compared to £50.2 billion in 2020. That is a significant and substantial increase. And part of what the government needs to do is bake the right assumptions into its financial plans at the start of the financial year. It is not simply a question of constantly pointing the finger at UK governments. Deputy Presiding Officer, we need a clear and unflinching view of the challenges, not one that simply seeks to blame mechanisms. Ultimately, this is about making policy that is sustainable within the fiscal envelope that we know that we have in front of us. We also need a commitment for reform of our public services, because we will need to reform them to meet the challenges, and a commitment to sustainability. But above all else, we need a commitment and a focus on growing jobs and growing wages, because that is the route to financial sustainability for this country. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. I now call on Ross Greer, a generous 6 minutes. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm glad we're here and have the opportunity for this debate, long overdue as it is, as pointed out by Les Smith. This is the first debate of quite a finance-heavy week, so a few of us will be seeing quite a lot of each other in the Chamber between now and Thursday afternoon. I think it is quite helpful for the debates to be taking place in this sequence. We all recognise that Scotland's public finances are unsustainable. We clearly, in some cases, quite profoundly disagree on the solutions, though, which is why bringing it as a debate to this chamber is so important, so that we can thrash out these issues and actually identify some of the areas where there is at least a majority, or in a few cases, maybe even consensus on the solutions. I think one of the fundamental questions that we need to address, though, when we're talking about fiscal sustainability, is about the role and the size of the state. I've said before in debates on public sector reform that as a socialist, I'm a fan of a big state. I think that government should be the expression of the popular will of society. It's where we share power and resources to do transformational things, and in particular, to protect our most vulnerable neighbours and the planet that we live on. Big challenges like the deeply embedded inequality present in the UK and the climate crisis require a big coordinated response of the kind that I think only government can lead the delivery of. I want to see a bigger state in Scotland doing more to meet the needs of people and planet, but I don't just want what we've got now on a larger scale. We need far, far more efficient and accountable service provision, and that's key to the sustainability question, because as Daniel Johnson was pointing out towards the end of his remarks, we are trying to achieve some really big goals, some shared visions around areas like the climate or child poverty within a very tight spending envelope. So if we're to have any chance of achieving those goals, we do need to get better value for money than we have been so far. Our public services need to perform better. I was with other Finance Committee colleagues in Estonia a couple of weeks ago, and I think on a cross-party basis we were hugely impressed by the efficiency of their public sector. And it's not all replicable. There's a huge level of access that public and some private institutions have to individuals' personal data that I don't think would fly here for civil liberties reasons. In the post-Soviet context of Estonia, it was still a huge leap forward for their personal freedoms. It would be a step backwards, I think, for us. But there are some really basic points that I think are comparable or transferable, like having compatible data storage and transfer solutions across every public sector body and indeed private contractors. We have different teams within the same public agencies in this country who can't even communicate effectively with each other or transfer data to each other. And the efficiency savings from that are significant. There's plenty of low-hanging fruit, I think. You know, one area that I've highlighted before is around the copywriting of public data. The David Hume Institute estimates that that loses about £2 to £3 billion to the Scottish economy every year. Yes.
Ms. Smith.
I think the member is making an interesting point. And in relation to our Estonian experience, does he agree that one of the great attributes of the way that the Estonians work their economy is the very considerable cooperation and effective cooperation between the public and private sectors?
Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome that intervention. Committed as I am to significant state involvement in the economy eventually, I do think there's a lot for us to learn right now in the integration of public and private sector, and particularly the transfer of highly skilled individuals from the private sector into what were essentially sabbaticals into public office to bring their very particular expertise, particularly in areas of digital technology. But on the point around the openness of public data, if I could just finish off on this point, Mr. Whitfield. Point around public data. The Scottish Government, I think, should be credited for operating an open government licence and making its data available. Very few councils in Scotland do, despite my encouraging them to. But in researching for this debate, I couldn't find a single NDPB or agency in Scotland, any of the bodies that are accountable to the Scottish Government, who also operated an open government licence. So if we have a government that's committed to making public data available, we need to make sure that cascades through all the bodies that it is responsible for, because there's a direct efficiency saving there. There's also a productivity boost to the economy. I'll take Mr. Whitfield now.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the member giving way, and it was in fact on that very point. What we have is an opportunity here in Scotland for the government to lead, particularly when we look at software, hardware and data. And we see it, we are starting to see it in data, but also, and then I think that speaks to the Estonia point, that there is a greater understanding and commitment from the whole of the community there to share and to understand the significance of others. And you've referenced, and my apologies for the length of this, you've referenced the ability of skilled labour to come in from the private sector to support the government. And that's stuff that we should promote here in Scotland.
Ross Greene, give you the time back.
Thank you, and I strongly agree with that point. And one of the most interesting experiences that we had on that committee visit was meeting the, if I'm getting her title correct, the Secretary General of the Estonian Economy Ministry, who was on a five-year sabbatical from one of their tech unicorn companies, bringing a level of expertise that realistically is very challenging for us to attract in the public sector here in Scotland for the simple reason of salary competitiveness. But there is a lot to learn there, particularly in how they've fostered that sense of civic obligation of highly skilled individuals in the private sector taking time out to contribute towards the state. And I do think those of us on the left should talk more about public sector reform, because we are coming at it from the perspective not to reform the public sector to shrink it and save money, but to get increasing value for that overall spend. That being said, we won't balance the books on efficiencies alone. There's a few points that I want to touch on before closing. And the first is around the need to reform the fiscal framework. We absolutely agree with the government on the need for greater borrowing powers to invest, for there to be no cap on the Scottish Government's borrowing ability. If a cap is to be imposed, an arbitrary cap, it should at the very least be for this Parliament to decide that. Now, I would argue against it. I think the European Union's experience shows the dangers of implementing arbitrary caps and then shock events like the pandemic turning them into significant barriers to intervention. But at the very least, it should be for this Parliament to decide if Scottish Government borrowing powers are capped. I think one of the areas that borrowing can result in significant value from is around the digital transformation of the public sector. Significant upfront costs involved, but huge savings further down the line. The lack of in-year flexibility is a significant issue. I've mentioned before that the path to balance exercise the Scottish Government engages in a year-by-year basis, I think, is resulting in disproportionate cuts being made to areas like education versus areas like justice, because some spending is so fixed at the start of the year. And as Daniel Johnson pointed out, we've got into an annual habit of these exercises. So year on year on year, areas like education and health are taking a greater hit. The final point I'd make on the fiscal framework before closing is its incompatibility with the realities of the climate crisis. The Scottish Fiscal Commission have made that clear. The best way to exemplify that is the fact that if it floods in Somerset and the UK government intervenes to support households, the Scottish government will get Barnett consequentials. If it floods in Stonehaven, the UK government expects the Scottish government to fund that out of its existing limited resources. So there's a clear need to reform the fiscal framework to deal with the realities of the climate crisis. So in closing, I look forward to the rest of the debate. I think we've identified quite a lot of the challenges. We have identified some solutions that there's some cross-party agreement on, but I hope in the second half of this afternoon we start to identify some of those solutions that I think we can at least form a majority, if not, as I said, a consensus around. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Greer. I now call Willie Rennie again, a generous 6 minutes. Mr. Rennie.
It was quite a pragmatic, sensible contribution from Ross Greer this afternoon, and I think it does actually help. I don't sound so surprised that it was a sensible and pragmatic contribution. Actually, I think there were some very reasonable points, but it does actually reinforce one of the issues I was going to raise earlier on, because for as long as I can remember, we have been debating the demographic time bomb. For decades, we have known this was coming. But for decades, this place and other political forums carry on making tacit references to it, but without actually dealing with the real consequences of it. And as a result, we have to firefight. Every single year, we have to make decisions, in-year cuts, more drastic in the last 2 years than I think I've ever seen before. But despite all the warnings from the Fiscal Commission more recently, Fraser Avallander, and in fact, the government's own medium-term financial strategy in 2021, which was quite stark, it said that there were challenging financial situation, a falling living standards, higher inflation, and issues around capital funding. But despite that, the Scottish Government went on to increase entitlements, valid in their own right, but increase entitlements with that backdrop. And as a result, we are now firefighting. Now, to be fair to the government, in its early days, it did make attempts to try and change the way that the public sector operated. The Christie Commission, I think, was a good effort. It did try to bring consensus across the political parties. To reach out to Campbell Christie in itself was a good effort. There was an attempt to bring in change funds. That's hardly mentioned anymore. It doesn't appear, apart from, again, tacit references to the debate. So I think we do need to, at last, make this debate part of all the debates that we have in this Parliament about finance, because we will carry on having firefighting year in, year out. Yes.
Ms. Smith.
That commitment, would he agree with the Finance Committee members that it would be quite good to have a finance bill as part of the permanent fixture of this Parliament?
Willie Rennie.
I think it would, because it would elevate the status of the budget process and give members a greater opportunity to discuss the individual elements of that budget. Because just now, it's primarily a debate between finance spokespeople in a very limited way through a budgetary process where we haggle about what extra we're going to get as part of that budget process. And that doesn't really deal with the fundamental financial issues that we address. Now, one of the issues that's not been raised today is about participation. Economic inactivity in Scotland has diverged from the rest of the United Kingdom. It is lower than it is in the rest of the... it's higher than it is in the rest of the United Kingdom. Between 2001 and 2015, the UK and Scotland were along the same path, but then there was a divergence, and our position deteriorated while the rest of the UK improved. I understand why that is. Why did that happen? And what are we doing to address it? Because the consequences of that are quite striking, particularly around about healthcare. And I think a lot of it is associated sometimes with the poor performance of the healthcare system. Because if we can't treat people quickly to get them back into work, they rely on benefits, and therefore they become more dependent on the state. And the longer they're out of work, the more difficult it is to get them back into the workplace. And I have several examples in my constituency of that happening. Taxes. We have to answer the question, can we tax our way out of this problem? And I think the simple answer to that is no, we can't. Now, I'm in favour, and I have been in favour, of specified taxes for a particular purpose to have a big return. But if we believe that raising taxes on a forever basis is going to resolve this demographic problem, I think we're kidding ourselves. We are not going to manage to do that. And we've seen from behavioural change, we get a fraction of what was intended to raise from these tax rises. And the effect is, just let me finish this point. And the effect is that people make behavioural decisions to become less involved within the economy. Either, and we've not seen great evidence of it yet, of lots of people crossing the border to the south, but we do see people reducing their hours and making other decisions about their employment practices. Yes.
Ross Greer.
Thank you. I'm grateful for the intervention. Obviously, our parties disagree somewhat on some of the fundamentals around tax, but I'm wondering if he agrees with me that one of the core issues we have in Scotland is an entire tier of government that has very little ability to raise its own revenue. If we talk about Scotland as a normal European country, it's not normal for local government to be unable to raise most of its own revenue. I think in Scotland it's less than 20%. Surely that's a structural issue.
Willie Rennie can give you the time back.
God, I'm agreeing with Ross Greer far too often these days. Yes, I think local government should have the ability to raise the majority of the money that it spends. It should have the flexibility to be able to do that. And I think we'll get better decisions at a local level rather than just being dependent on central government. So I think that is certainly the case. Now, I want to deal with some of the issues around about change, which speaks to Ross Greer's point earlier on. We're terrible at change. Whenever we make an attempt to make a big bang change, for instance, closing a hospital, investing in primary care instead, there are hills of derision about that. And I'm sure I've been involved in such campaigns. But as a whole, as a parliament, we are not succeeding on delivering change. Because every time a building's involved, we never stand up and say the longer-term benefit is what we should be aiming for. And we have seen opportunities within local health boards to make that change. But the inevitable attraction of the secondary care is much more attractive than primary care. We have most people go through the primary care system, fewer people go into the secondary care system. So how are we going to make sure that majority of people get the primary service that they need in primary care? That's what we should be aiming for. And secondly, on digital, we spend a fraction on digital investment compared with what industry invests in. And we are surprised that when you phone up Kirkcaldy Hospital to find out how a family's members getting on in the hospital in Edinburgh, they have to phone them up. Why do we not have a digital system that's able to communicate across the country to find out? Why do we have different measurement systems in one hospital, even one department from another, that makes it impossible to build an artificial intelligence and digital systems? We are in the arc ages for this. This needs to change. But we are terrible at diverting investment away from entitlements that we want to invest to get ourselves elected for the next election, and longer-term investments that will make a real difference for the benefit of our constituency. And finally, is universities. Universities are amongst the finest asset we've got in this country. But you wouldn't think it. We hardly talk about universities in this place, other than student finance, which Liberal Democrats are never allowed to mention. But universities are a great asset for the country. They bring people from across the globe, academics, students, investment, industry. But where is the real focus from the government to maximise the potential of that in the same way that they do in California? There isn't that focus. Now, if we are able to focus on the things that are greater, renewable energy that's coming with ScotWind, instead of spending the money to fill the hole in the financial problems, why are we not making sure that ScotWind is really a benefit for the country in the long term? We're not doing that, and I hope the supply chain work comes off, but if we're going to siphon the money off to pay for day-to-day spending, we're not going to achieve that. So these are all the big opportunities that we've got in this country. I agree with Ross Greer. There are many things that we can agree on to make real changes, but we're going to have to change the way that this Parliament works if we're going to deliver it.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I note a member who is looking to participate in the open debate has left during the opening speeches. I'll expect an explanation and an apology. But with that, I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Liz Smith. A generous 6 minutes, Ms Thompson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start my remarks with just a few thoughts on the UK budget tomorrow. Just as every citizen will be concerned about the sustainability of their own finances, not least pensioners and low-income households, government will very quickly have to consider the implications for budget sustainability. Thus far, the omens are slightly mixed. The UK Labour government made pre-election commitments to protect working people from tax rises, but are unable to define what they mean by a working person. But leaving aside the confusion the UK government's created, I want to start with a critical consideration of a major policy change that trailed changes to the fiscal rules. The pre-election commitment to stick with the Tories' fiscal rules have been dumped, at least in part, and I welcome the fact that the road to Damascus has been somewhat short. It now seems clear that borrowing for investment is no longer to be considered as debt, but rather as asset creation. And this could allow for a significant increase in infrastructure investment, which I welcome. But this has potentially major implications for the Scottish Government. As we know, and I have often commented on, the Scottish Government under devolution has very limited capital borrowing powers. This, some have argued, is to prevent the devolved government from adding to UK debt. But if redefining investment as asset creation rather than debt makes sense for the UK, by all logic, surely the same must apply to Scotland. So I wonder if the Minister will commit to engaging with the UK Government on this matter. On June of this year, the Finance and Public Administration Committee launched its call for evidence to inform its pre-budget scrutiny. And this has attracted some very insightful contributions, and in most cases, there's support for the Government's four priority areas. And I found the evidence from the Fraser of Allender Institute particularly telling when he argued, and I quote, "Ultimately, the most important thing to come from the 25-26 Scottish budget will be to what extent the measures that are implemented will reflect these priorities. These priorities are broadly the same as last year, but given that decisions in the 24-25 Scottish budget did not necessarily chime with those priorities, a new approach will be needed to ensure that the situation is different this time around." So achieving fiscal sustainability whilst maintaining a focus on key priorities is very challenging but utterly critical. And in that regard, I'm sympathetic to submissions from the Royal Society of Edinburgh and the Scottish Chamber of Commerce when they argue that growing the economy is the most important priority and will underpin the ability to address the other three, not least because the public finances will grow if the economy grows. It's also a much more effective approach than simply burdening the economy and individuals with more tax hikes. In other words, to my mind, growing the economy will contribute to both fiscal sustainability and pursuit of the government's priorities, and there is no sustainable alternative. I'd also point out that growing the economy will positively impact the lives of many of those living and working in Scotland, not least through enhancing employment prospects and household incomes. And in some specific areas, there are opportunities to target investment in a manner that supports all four priorities, perhaps the most obvious being investing in new affordable house building. Of course, there are other matters to take into account to ensure fiscal sustainability, from public sector pay policy, which we've discussed, to tax policy that's come up, and I'm sure many others in this debate as we continue focus on. But before concluding, I want to reflect on a further concern raised in the evidence by the Scottish Women's Budget Group and the Women's Economic Empowerment Group project, namely the tackling of barriers to women being able to take on work. Such barriers are, as inability to access affordable and accessible childcare inhibit economic growth. And this is something that the Scottish Government has come out very strongly to support women going into work. However, as I've previously argued in this Parliament, we need further sex-based research into the impact of public policy as part of the drive to improve economic policy development. So, in summary then, enhancing the Scottish Government's ability to borrow and invest, and now reframed as asset creation, a commitment to the critical priority of growing the economy and sound policy development are all part of achieving fiscal sustainability. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. And I call Liz Smith to be followed by Claire Hawkey, around 6 minutes. Ms Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I have to say the fact that I find myself agreeing with Michael Mara, with Willie Rennie, with Ross Greer and with Michelle Thompson on some issues, by no means all, and indeed with the Cabinet Secretary on one point, shows, I think that this debate is actually very important because it is raising some of the issues that we should have been talking about long ago. And I think, you know, one of the things that I think frustrated the Finance Committee was that we should have had this debate a year and a half ago, at the time where the Fiscal Commission was really calling for it, because it is important that we are debating long-term sustainability, not the situation where we've got certainly the government's got itself into, where we're debating on a short-term basis. Now, I do think we have to set the debate in context, firstly to acknowledge that there are some issues, as the Cabinet Secretary set out herself, which are not easily influenced by the Scottish Government, demographic trends being one, latest ones published just yesterday, most especially about the increasing size of the dependent population and the fact that improvements in medical science are obviously keeping more of us alive to an older age and in need of much greater health and social care. But of course, there are lots of other issues which are much more influenced by the Scottish Government. Firstly, on tax structures, which, as David Bell has pointed out, do not currently reflect sufficient transparency or simplicity, a point that my colleague Craig Hoy raised. The core Adam Smith principles, which have guided the fiscal work of this Parliament for all 25 years. And thirdly, and absolutely crucially, the ability to bring in sufficient revenue. How many times has the Finance Committee complained that not nearly enough work has been done to measure the relevant tax elasticities and the resulting behavioural change? And I know elasticities, when it comes to economic theory, may be seen at very much at the esoteric end of that theory, but they absolutely matter. And I know that Michelle Thompson is somebody who's asked about this a lot in committee, because they affect our behavioural change. And so we need to do much more on that, particularly for the long term. Of course.
John Mason.
Yeah, thank the member very much for giving way. Would she accept, too, that one of the issues we need to look at is the fiscal framework? And there were figures came out at the weekend which suggest that Scotland is losing year by year as a percentage of GDP spending. Does that not need to be looked at?
Well, Liz Smith.
I certainly think that there should be an ongoing basis of looking at fiscal frameworks, not just between the Scottish and the UK government, but between the Scottish government and local authorities. Mr Mason and I will fundamentally disagree about some of the problems within that fiscal framework, which I think very much to be to the benefit of Scotland rather than to its detriment. But I do accept that we have to keep a watching brief on that, because that is a fundamental part of the way that devolution should work. But there is this question of public sector reform, which, as the Chamber knows, the committee believes is happening at far too slow a pace. And that's something that's been flagged up by Audit Scotland. And there are too many of the changes in this that are rather shrouded in mystery. And I just pick out something that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation was saying in its most recent report, that it's not actually all that easy to determine the relationships between the policies to tackle child poverty and the outcomes, much as they are extremely important policies to do so, but actually measuring the changes that we need to have is not all that easy. And of course, there is this different but nonetheless very much related question of public sector pay policy, because the Cabinet Secretary is very well aware of the concern expressed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission that for the most recent round of public sector pay negotiations, there was a lack of a clear policy on which forecasting could be based, either on the short term or on the medium term. And I think that's something that we need to address. Now, I think this would be the third time in this chamber that I would put on record my dismay about the last Scottish Government budget, that there was an 8.3% real terms cut in the economy portfolio, which undermines some of the employability and skills issues that Daniel Johnson was eloquently talking about. Because these are not just for the now, these are for the longer term. And I think Daniel Johnson and indeed Ben McPherson were flagging up that we have to do some really serious thinking about how we address that in the future. Because Willie Rennie was correct when he said about the increase in the rate of economic inactivity. That is serious. We have a fundamental problem about the rate of economic inactivity, because these are often people whose skills we desperately need, and for one reason or another, they have chosen to come out of the labour market when they are actually able to work. Now, that's different from people who can't work and who've got genuine issues with health. But we need, desperately need, these people to be part of the whole scenario. Then I just want to conclude my comments on saying something about capital, because Michelle Thompson is quite right when she says that there was a real terms cut in the capital budget, which in turn has affected infrastructure development. And the SNP is right to mention this, although they are on much less certain ground, given all the waste which they have been responsible for in some capital projects, when they complain that none of this is their fault. Now, I don't often agree with Lord Mandelson, you will be pleased to hear, but in his recent Reform Scotland lecture, he was quite correct to say that the UK has been far too short-termist in its approach to capital investment. That's something the Financial Times reported on recently. That needs to change, even if it means choosing investment over consumption. And if that is the case, we need Scotland to be a much more attractive place in which to live and work, free from punitive and uncompetitive tax structures, much more supportive of business, entrepreneurship and innovation, and run by a Scottish Government which recognises the need for stability and for fiscal sustainability, which to date is slightly questionable.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call Claire Hawkey to be followed by Ben McPherson, around 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. Last year's fiscal sustainability report from the Scottish Fiscal Commission highlighted where current pressures in Scotland's public finances lie and where they could lie in the future. It identified the particular challenges that Scotland faces now, in part as a result of our changing demographic profile, and in particular the financial challenges faced across our public services. As was made clear by the First Minister when presenting this year's programme for government, the Scottish Government is focusing on four clear priorities: eradicating child poverty, building prosperity, improving our public services and protecting the planet. And these priorities are, of course, all closely interlinked. And we know that living in poverty is damaging for our health at all ages and stages of life. And we know that when we tackle poverty, our health and well-being improves as a result, ultimately helping reduce pressure on public services. And on the converse, put simply, investment in public services pays for itself, leading to an economic boost, a healthier society and better long-term outcomes for children and young people. The challenges faced by our public services are, of course, not just the result of demographic change, but rising energy costs and the ongoing impacts of COVID and Brexit. And crucially, years of austerity under successful Westminster governments. Presiding Officer, Scotland's block grant is at its lowest share in a decade. House of Commons research shows that in a like-for-like comparison, the Scottish block grant has suffered a real-terms cut every year since 2020 and is now worth £4.6 billion less than it was in 2020. And just last year, the capital block grant was cut by nearly 10% and it faces a further cut this year. The Scottish Government is, of course, also constrained by the requirement to balance its budget with extremely limited borrowing powers. And with these constraints and the other financial limitations of devolution, difficult decisions have had to be taken along the way. Though the SNP government has worked to continue delivering its priorities and protecting our public services. The Scottish Government has a strong track record of improving lives in these challenging circumstances, having delivered an expansion of funded childcare to 1140 hours for every 3- and 4-year-old, record investment in the NHS, renewable energy development and the introduction of the Scottish Child Payment. Even when faced with unprecedented budgetary constraints, the SNP Government's aim will be to improve people's lives by focusing on clear priorities that make the biggest difference, and to be a fiscally responsible government that balances its budget every year. And for the past 17 years, SNP governments have balanced the books and will do so again this year. The Scottish Government's funding is, of course, inextricably linked into the UK government's spending decisions, yeah, with Scotland's fiscal sustainability subject to the impact of reductions in UK spending via the block grant. And, Presiding Officer, we're still waiting the unveiling of the UK budget tomorrow. Many column inches have been written and will be written over the coming days about what the UK budget will mean for families, for businesses and for our public services. It would be fair to say that the mood music from the Labour Party and trailed in the press has been anything but upbeat, with the Prime Minister yesterday saying that Britain must embrace the harsh light of fiscal reality, yeah, and being clear that this budget will be, and I quote, painful. The words of Anas Sarwar, read my lips, no austerity under Labour, are already ringing hollow to my senior Rutherglen constituents, yeah, whose winter fuel payments has been cut, leaving people feeling angry, scared of fuel bills that they can't afford, and the very real fear of having to choose between heating or eating. The fact is, you can't cut your way to prosperity or better public services, and you can't eradicate poverty by making people poorer. Presiding Officer, health spending is the largest component of the Scottish budget, and there have already been very concerning reports about leaked UK government health and social care spending plans. Several newspapers have reported that the health budget in England may be expecting a settlement which equates to around a 4% rise, which is about £7 billion. To put this in context, the British Medical Association has called for a minimum of £13 billion. Other commentators have estimated that a £16 billion increase is the bare minimum needed to close the gaps and deliver an improvement in NHS England, an increase which would deliver an additional £1.6 billion for Scotland. If these leaked reports are true, and this is the level of health and social care funding that will be announced tomorrow, one thing is clear. The Labour government is planning to continue Westminster's chronic underfunding of public services, which has done so much damage over the past 14 years. In the face of this ongoing challenge, the Scottish government has stepped in to support people in services where it has been needed most. But it has done so without equivalent action from the UK government, which has repeatedly failed to properly review the adequacy of funding settlements. The only way that social, economic and environmental challenges that Scotland is facing can be tackled is through the delivery of sustainable building for public services. And as the UK Secretary of State for Health and Social Care himself has said, all roads lead back to Westminster. Labour swept into power on the promise of positive change for the people across this country, and now their Prime Minister admits that things are actually going to get worse. The Scottish Government will continue to work with the UK Government wherever it can, and will continue to urge it to drop the damaging cuts and set new spending rules that support investment. And will do everything it can to protect the services and the public from Westminster's attack on Scotland's public spending. Ultimately, however, Scotland should have the full powers to invest in our people, our public services and the planet as a way to build a more prosperous country. And ultimately, Scotland would be best served by the full range of fiscal powers, choices and opportunities that independence would bring.
Thank you. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Katie Clark. Around 6 minutes, Mr McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome this opportunity to speak in this important debate about our collective fiscal sustainability. Looking back, considering where we are, and thinking about where we go from here. When it comes to the story of the United Kingdom economy and public finances over the period of the last years, it's hard not to feel anything but sadness and depression at the self-inflicted damage that has been done to ourselves. This cloud of austerity has not only been psychologically negative for the country as a whole, but has, of course, has real-world consequences, damaging GDP, resulting in a sense of apathy socially, which arguably led to very bad decisions like the Brexit vote elsewhere in the UK. More pressure on public services, which just builds up and builds up and builds up, and made it more difficult when we had to deal with external events like the COVID pandemic. The list goes on. Austerity was a choice before the 2010 coalition government, but certainly since, and at a UK level. And combined with unnecessarily low pay in the private sector particularly, this did a huge amount of social and economic damage in the UK and led, arguably, to a sense of decline. What it also removed from both the public and the private sector was the capacity for flexibility. So for things like investing in more community justice, taking forward the Christie principles, these things, whether it's in Scotland or elsewhere in the UK, were reduced in capacity because there just wasn't that flexibility in the public finances to be able to do these things to the extent that would have made a real meaningful difference. And when we look at other countries across Europe in particular who didn't make that choice, you see the difference in the damage that's been made. You see higher GDP. You see less need for public spending because they haven't created the social problems that we have here in the UK. So how do we move forward? Well, there are no easy fixes. How do we find solutions? There have been no easy fixes. But the Scottish Government, with its limited powers, has undoubtedly made a more positive situation here in Scotland. First of all, in terms of wages, using public sector wage increases has had both a positive effect on the social justice outcomes that are achieved by that, but also has had an indirect effect in the private sector because the labour market is competitive, and that has undoubtedly made a difference, combined with social security. I mean, the reason social security spending is where it is, not just in Scotland but the rest of the UK, is because the cost of living is so high. So we should really arguably be talking more about the need to somehow stabilise the cost of living, particularly with regard to housing costs, before we try and address the situation with social security. Because remember, and we've said this across parties in this chamber for many years, we want people to claim the social security that they're entitled to. It's in the 2018 Act to encourage people to do that because it's the right thing to do. And we've done good work reducing stigma around social security. Let's be careful about how we talk about social security going forward so we don't unwind any of that good work that's been done. Migration, people have talked about it. Do you want to take it?
Daniel Johnson.
Sorry, I will get around to President. Thank you to the member. I think really what I was trying to say, and I think he was alluding to my remarks earlier, is that we just need to ensure that Social Security is sustainable and it's joined up in policy terms. And ultimately, that's what Social Security should be doing. And I'm sure we need to be constantly and rigorously looking at whether it's designed in that way. I wondered if the member would sort of take my clarification.
I think
that's an important point, and it also it connects to an important challenge that we're going to face in this Parliament, which is the fact that disability benefits are devolved and universal credit is reserved. And actually, I think we need to think very seriously about calling for universal credit through a sensible time frame to be devolved to this Parliament, because they are, although disability benefits are not means tested, the issues are connected. Another area where we should be seeking more power, where there has been strong consensus in the past, is in terms of migration. It's not a panacea, but the work's been done through migration helping Scotland prosper, the policy making that was done at that time in 2020. It would not require a different border control. There is plenty precedent in Australia and Canada. It is something deliverable with a Scottish tax code. We've done the hard policy making. We could easily progress to a better position constitutionally on that. As I said, the more we can do in terms of support, whether it's childcare funding, housing, security, the more that we can establish a stronger position of security for our people, the more likely we're able to have a positive effect on the birth rate, which is also important in this regard, of course. With regard to more powers, the arguments that the Scottish Government have made, both in the motion today and more generally around borrowing powers, to me are unquestionable. No matter which political party was in power in the Scottish Government, they would want more borrowing powers in order to build the capacity in our economy and our public sector and to undertake public sector reform. We need more capital available to the Scottish Government. It is an undeniable truth in my view. And in terms of what that would mean for the people I represent, just briefly, Presiding Officer, is that the Cabinet Secretary talked about the challenges demographically in terms of population decline and the demographic change. Edinburgh is a bit of a different scenario, along with the rest of the Lowlands. Huge population increases, people moving here because it's so attractive, massive economic growth and innovation taking place. We have to support the Edinburgh economy and Edinburgh's infrastructure. It's so critical to the wider Scottish economy. And in terms of the people I represent of North Edinburgh, which has its rich parts and its poorer parts, the possibility for the Grant and Waterfront development that the Cabinet Secretary has thankfully given so much of our time and consideration to in recent years, and the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice was there yesterday, and it was great to be with her in North Edinburgh. What the Grant and Waterfront development could do for the people of North Edinburgh and some of Edinburgh's wider challenges would be, in my view, as transformational as what the Dundee Waterfront redevelopment has done for Dundee, for example. So any more further capital from the UK budget and what we could do with capital borrowing powers in places like North Edinburgh would undeniably make an important difference.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I now call Katie Clark to be followed by Kevin Stewart, around 6 minutes. Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate is making clear our long-term economic financial sustainability is a matter of great importance across the Chamber, and I welcome the detail provided in the Fiscal Sustainability Report by the Scottish Fiscal Commission in 2023, which outlines some of the long-term challenges we face, many of which are highly alarming. It was interesting that Ross Grier said that we all accept that Scotland's fiscal position is unsustainable. And when Willie Rennie says that we have been debating the demographic time bomb for decades, because I have to say that that I have found neither of those issues central to the debates that I've heard in this Parliament in the 3.5 years that I have been here. And I think part of what this debate is about is actually making some of those issues central across the party political divide in this chamber. Because, of course, this debate links to a far wider debate about our economy and how we raise the money we need to fund the high-quality public services that most people in Scotland want, and how we ensure that all of the population in Scotland have a reasonable quality of life. As Liz Smith said, it is disappointing that the committee has had to wait 18 months for this debate on the report. And I think also it's now disappointing that we're having this debate, but that the Scottish Government motion doesn't even mention the Fiscal Sustainability Report, and the tendency that I think we all have to fall into party political knockabout, because the challenges we face are clearly long-term and very serious. The challenges of an ageing population, the sustainability of public services are going to be challenges that will be with us after tomorrow's budget and are issues that we need to grapple with in this Parliament. The motion refers to a 5-year fiscal sustainability delivery plan without providing detail under the Scottish Government's approach to the budget tomorrow. And it may well be that some of what the Cabinet Secretary is seeking is announced in the budget tomorrow, or indeed will be achieved in the discussions that I know that she is involved with on an ongoing basis. But the long-term challenges we face of an ageing population, of climate change, of deindustrialisation, of economic inactivity, of a failure to deliver growth and to effect redistribution in our society need serious space for debate, and a long-term debate about how we create the solutions that are needed. I think one of the strengths of this Parliament is actually there's a huge amount of political consensus compared, for example, to Westminster. And I think as a Parliament, we would be able to reach a consensus on many of these issues. We know that it is predicted that we will continue to see a rise in our ageing population, with fewer children being born, with a predicted population decline of up to 8% over the next 50 years, which will have a significant impact on tax revenue that's collected for future governments to spend in public services, as well as the obvious substantial additional costs to our social security budgets, our National Health Service, our social care services and other services, with an ageing population requiring more services, not yet. The projected demographic changes outlined in the Fiscal Commission report cannot be underestimated. Total spending on devolved public services is estimated to be £54 billion in 2027-28, but by the end of the projection period in 2072-73, the Scottish Fiscal Commission project that this spending increases to 123% to £120 billion in today's prices. And that's with none of the ambitions that many of us in this chamber have to improve the failing public services that we have, that no doubt requires additional funding being taken into account. Health, of course, is the largest component of Scottish Government spending. It grows more quickly than other areas, according to projections made. And health spending increases from 35% of devolved spending in the report to 50% by 2072-73. Yes, there will be future demographic changes amongst young people too that may mean some falls in expenditure. For example, education spending is expected to fall as a share of Scottish Government spending if we continue to have the population trends that we have at the moment, from 18% to 11%. But the impact of climate change, I think, is almost impossible to quantify in economic terms, and will no doubt dominate the future decisions of this Parliament. I think it's fair to say that none of us have the policies that are needed yet that may be required to address some of the challenges that are going to come as we continue to face a situation where we miss our climate challenges and climate targets and fail to prepare properly for the economic impact of climate change. Presiding Officer, this debate, as I say today, I think needs to be focused on those long-term challenges that we face, and I hope genuinely that in this Parliament, where there is a consensus on many issues, that we will seriously grapple with the kind of policies that are needed to be delivered in Scotland that are going to make the differences that need to be made.
Thank you. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Colette Stevenson in around 6 minutes. Mr Stewart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it's one of those debates today where you come into the chamber and you think to yourself that you're going to say one thing and then you move in entirely a different direction. But I think there's a number of things today which we've not really covered to the degree that we should. Because I do believe that we need to have a fiscal sustainability delivery plan. I believe that the UK is an outlier compared to most Western European countries which have financial planning that are sometimes decades in terms of the strategies, and that often those strategies barely change when there are changes of government. But what we have in the UK, what we have had forever, is short-term thinking, short-term financial planning, and it does not take account of the major issues of the day, like demographic change, the changes that are taking place in society in terms of climate change and a change in the economic landscape. And I think the other things that have not been touched upon today, which most definitely should be, are some of the issues that have had a major impact on the economy and on public finances. And some of those things are unexpected shocks, like COVID, like the Russian invasion of Ukraine and the impact on international prices. But some of the shocks that we have had here have been entirely self-made by Westminster politicians. Austerity, the trust budget, and Brexit have all had a major impact on our economy and a major impact on the amount of money that governments have to spend. And I think we should not forget these issues, because they are very pertinent to today's debate. Now, we cannot escape the nature of devolved government, and in terms of the asks that the Finance Secretary has made at the end of our motion about immediately granting the Scottish Government increased capital alongside additional borrowing and investment powers to allow for greater investment to renew and enhance public infrastructure and deliver projects that support the transition to net zero, are good aims. In my opinion, they don't go far enough, because there is a real difficulty that we have with revenue, with day-to-day spend. And we cannot escape the nature of devolved government and the devolution settlement, which leaves Scottish Government funding at the whim of UK departmental spending. Now, what I would say now is that the Labour government needs to end austerity. Anna Sarwar said as Claire Hawkey intimated earlier on, read my lips, no austerity under Labour. I hope that tomorrow we will see that move, but I have my doubts. Because the UK government needs to increase UK departmental spending in real terms to allow the Scottish Government the capacity to tackle the challenges that Scotland faces. Scotland has suffered immensely from years of Tory austerity, and it can't suffer years of Labour austerity. The Scottish Government's block grant has suffered a real terms cut in every year since 2020. That's years of unending cuts. The block grant is now worth £6.4 billion less than it was in 2020-21, a drop of 12.7%. But Westminster austerity isn't just cuts to government departmental spending. It has also meant direct cuts to the most vulnerable in our society. Austerity is the two-child cap, taking funds from children and hard-pressed families. And austerity is cutting the winter fuel allowance for pensioners who are just scraping by. Austerity is cutting social security for sick and disabled people. And if we... I'll give way to Mr Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
Does the member agree with the Scottish Fiscal Commission report?
Kevin Stewart.
Actions. But I have to say to Mr Rennie and to others in the chamber today that we cannot ignore the facts that much of our spending is dependent on money that comes from the UK. Much of the difficulties that we are facing are because of the shocks, austerity, the trust budget, Brexit, problems caused by the UK. Austerity is a political choice, not an economic choice. It is a political choice to leave children hungry and pensioners frozen and the most vulnerable left living from hand to mouth. And all of these things have a long-term impact on people and has an impact on our health service and leads to a huge amount of crisis spend, which in my book we need to eradicate. We need to get it right for people right at the very heart. And yes, when it comes to government spending, the hard-won taxes of its citizens, efficiency and cutting waste should always be aimed for, but increases in efficiency should be used to fund more services, not simply to mitigate Westminster cuts. Now, we need to think big here, and some of us think bigger than others, because we believe,
members,
we believe that Scotland should control all of the levers of power in order for us to get this absolutely right for our people. Although austerity is a political choice, not an economic choice, it is an economic disaster. And austerity must end, and I hope that Labour live up to their expectations and begin that tomorrow. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our economy is struggling, and the effects of the pandemic and the war in Ukraine on rising costs have been really hard, including fuel bills going through the roof. But those international challenges have been exacerbated by the political choices made by Westminster governments. Scotland suffered 14 years of austerity from a Tory government we did not vote for, with huge consequences on public spending. We were dragged out of the European Union against our will, a decision estimated to cut revenue by £2.3 billion annually in Scotland. Now, to put that figure into context, the economic damage each year of Brexit is large enough to run Scotland's justice system for around 8 months, courts, prisons and the police service. Next, of course, we had the disastrous mini-budget from Liz Truss, leading to sky-high inflation and people's mortgages increasing drastically. We now have the Labour Party back in power in Westminster, and they promised change before the election. But all of their plans and policies sound like the same old Westminster austerity tune.
Yeah, yeah.
In fact, it seems that Labour don't have a clue what their policies actually are. Anna Sarwar infamously said, "Read my lips, no austerity under Labour before the election." While Keir Starmer and the now Chancellor seemed oblivious to the fact that keeping Tory fiscal rules would mean continued austerity. But as soon as they got into power, the Prime Minister said that people will have to suffer and that the October budget will be tough. And the Chancellor talked about a supposedly unknown black hole of £22 billion and pushed through public spending cuts. These actions from consecutive Westminster governments offer absolutely no fiscal sustainability. Unfortunately, in terms of fiscal policy, the Scottish Government is working with one hand tied behind its back. We have limited tax-raising powers, and the UK Government controls most economic levers and borrowing powers. However, despite those limitations, the SNP leads a fiscally responsible Scottish Government, which has delivered a balanced budget in each of the past 17 years. We also introduced a more progressive income tax, increasing the revenue available to the Scottish Government by around £1.5 billion this year, allowing us to protect people in Scotland from the full harms of the failed Westminster economic system. The SNP in government created the game-changing Scottish Child Payment as well, a policy which is helping to keep children out of poverty, with payments of over £100 per month for every eligible child. The SNP Scottish Government is spending £134 million this year to mitigate against some of the worst aspects of Westminster austerity, including the Labour-enforced bedroom tax. Of course, one of Labour's first choices in government was to scrap the winter fuel payment for millions of pensioners. This benefit was due to be devolved to Scotland this winter. However, with no notice, Labour scrapped the universal payment, a move which will cut Scotland's budget by around £160 million. This decision reinforces the fact that for as long as our budget is tied to decisions that are taken in Westminster, we will not be immune from the painful UK government budgets. In fact, in new analysis, the House of Commons Library found that Scotland's block grant is worth nearly £6.5 billion, or 13% less in real terms than it was in 2021. Tomorrow, the Chancellor must take a different approach in her first budget. Labour should learn the lessons of the past 14 years and not repeat the same damaging mistakes as the Tories. You can't cut your way to prosperity or better public services, and you can't eradicate poverty by making people poorer. In tomorrow's budget, Labour must reverse the winter fuel payment cuts, remove the two-child limit on benefits and deliver greater investment to tackle child poverty, and use the levers they have to end austerity. Presiding officer, economic experts have warned that continued austerity will damage public services and the economy, and that the Westminster fiscal framework has helped to drive this short-term thinking and created an inbuilt bias against investment. And in contrast, the SNP in government recognises the need for investment and for sustainable public finances. The Scottish Government will create a five-year fiscal sustainable delivery plan and will continue to invest our vital public services. Members across the Chamber should support these moves. And we also need to see the UK Government move to multi-year funding to provide more fiscal certainty. and I hope Labour use the powers they have in tomorrow's UK budget to end austerity and deliver investment in our public services.
Thank you, and I can confirm that we do have some time in hand, and I will give back time where interventions are taken. I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to contribute to today's debate, and I will be supporting the amendment in the name of my colleague Craig Hoy. Fiscal stability and sustainability is about making truly long-term policy decisions. It should be about ensuring public services are sustainable and we can be delivered for years to come and into the future. However, fiscal sustainability means accepting when difficult decisions have to be made and ensuring these decisions are not taken lightly, Presiding Officer. And these are the principles that we have on these benches championed, and we will continue to champion these principles going forward. When looking at Scotland's economy, it is clear that fiscal sustainability is as important now as it's ever been. Last year's report by the Scottish Fiscal Commission highlighted several significant challenges facing public services in the future. In many different areas of government spending, there is increasing pressures on our ageing population. And of course, that ageing population is not just unique to Scotland itself. These pressures could result in health budgets increasing to half of all devolved spending in the future. That's a real issue for us, Presiding Officer, into the future. It's also, of course, that it's disappointing that the Parliament has waited this long to debate this very issue, Presiding Officer, because it's been a considerable time since the report was highlighted. The findings of that report should have set alarm bells raising and rising in Scottish ministers' minds as to what was taking place. More recently on the issue, there have been some positive noises coming from the Scottish Government when it comes to this. But speaking just last week, the First Minister spoke about Scotland becoming a more economic a springboard with new growth and new opportunities and new hope. He also spoke about the important role of tax and how that plays in ensuring that we create a competitive tax offering for Scotland in the light of these challenges. Happy to.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Alexander Stewart to take away. Would you agree with some of the comments that we've heard that perhaps if we had a finance bill, it would draw attention to this on an annual basis in a far stronger way than has happened over the past 14 years?
Alexander Stewart.
I thank Martin Whitfield for that intervention. And yes, I think he makes a very sensible suggestion. And many of my colleagues on these benches have been talking about that for some considerable time. Yeah. And that would give us an opportunity to do things. Unfortunately, it's hard to believe the First Minister's rhetoric because he does not, and we have not seen that. The SNP have spent years making Scotland's tax offering anything but competitive. For example, the SNP's failure to grow the economy at the same rate as the rest of the United Kingdom has already cost this country financial stability. It was Graham Roy from the Scottish Fiscal Commission who talked about Scottish Government at the moment with over £600 million worth of revenue has been lost because of that. Presiding Officer, it tells a real story when we find that the fiscal stability and the record that goes on and the rhetoric that takes place is not the case. I'd like to make some more progress. The SNP focus while in government has not been on creating a thriving economy and encouraging creation of wealth. They haven't even managed to encourage Britain's brightest and best workers to move here and pay taxes and ensure that they create a business hive and supporting business within this community. That hasn't happened here either. Instead, we've seen the key drivers of Scotland's economy, prosperity, higher earnings, and they've hammered into the submission of the Scottish Government, and that has been at the disadvantage of economic prosperity. We also have seen short-term thinking by the Scottish Government when it comes to the college sector, which has suffered numerous real-term cuts over the last decade. Their outgoing chief executive has said that the decline in this sector will have
rhetorical, and the ideas about how things will come and will progress in the future is really difficult for that sector. So in the long run, the approach to Scotland's tax base has to be right. This kind of short-term thinking is exactly what we want to see and should be managing within our economy. And the fiscal side of things has to improve. And John Swinney himself has talked about the economy and the base and medium and long-term financial stability. But as I've said before, his actions and his deeds do not respect that and do not support that. Happy to do so.
Ross Greer.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the member for taking the intervention. I'm struggling a little bit with the line of argument he's making around the lack of investment and the lack of attraction of people to Scotland. Scotland outperforms every region of the UK apart from London and the South East for foreign direct investment, and we are net positive on inward migration from the rest of the UK. So how does he reconcile that line of argument with the numbers?
Alexander Stewart.
I mean, Ross Greer makes a point, but at the same time, business are telling us that they're having it really difficult to recruit people and that there is no real business confidence at what the Scottish Government is doing within the economy. So that doesn't add up and doesn't say the same. The Scottish Government should be using all of the powers to make Scotland an even more attractive place to live and work. And we've been calling for that for some time on these benches too. This debate has the opportunity for us to ensure that there is financial stability going forward. And it is important that we highlight the difficulties that are faced, but at the same time, we want solutions, Presiding Officer, to these. And the Scottish Government are not providing them. It also highlights just how much and how little the types of thinking that the Scottish Government have had when it comes to what they want to try and do to attract business, to create wealth, to ensure that we have prosperity, so we can support many of our services. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, there is an argument needed for this government to get a grip, change their strategy and build on the economy that Scotland will desperately require for the decades to come to ensure that we can have this whole financial stability and prosper, because that's what we all want to see. But at the moment, that's not happening. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call Fulton MacGregor, the final speaker in the open debate.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd firstly like to apologise for missing the final opening speech. It was unavoidable, but I would like the Chamber to know that it was not Willie Rennie's speech I was avoiding, absolutely not. So thank you, Presiding Officer, for that. And today we have debated the fiscal health of Scotland, and one thing has been made abundantly clear, that as long as we are tied to Westminster, Scotland will not be immune from painful UK government budgets. And this is not a matter of simply blaming Westminster for any financial hardships that may come. Is laying out the basic fact that while the SNP have balanced the budget every year since entering government, we are intrinsically tied to the economic factors stemming from decision-making in Westminster. No matter how well we budget, entirely preventable calamities such as Brexit and Liz Truss's autumn 22 budget will fundamentally affect how we operate our finances here in Scotland. So for the first time since 2010, we'll be looking to a party other than the Tories to present a UK budget. And I would implore the UK government to avoid the mistakes that we have seen time and time again over the last decade and a half. It is not controversial to say that you can't eradicate poverty by making people poorer. There are areas of my constituency of Coatbridge and Creyson which would be considered highly deprived, and the very last thing my constituents need is further austerity and cuts which cannot and will not bring about prosperity or better public services. The Labour Party can't tell them they're going to make them poorer and their lives tougher for the greater, longer-term good. It's just not acceptable. And I believe there are unanimous agreement across this chamber that poverty is the gravest social challenge facing Scotland today. Regrettably, reporting around this year's budget has left me and many others feeling that little will be done to address this with our new UK government tomorrow or going forward. Every week I talk to people across Coatbridge and Creyson who are worried about their futures and concerned about their financial well-being. My colleagues have already listed some reversals that the UK Government must consider, but I want to reiterate that my constituents would most benefit from the UK Government reversing its cut to the winter fuel payment, removing the two-child limit and benefits, and guarantee that greater investment to tackle child poverty, as well as funding for the NHS and schools, will be delivered. Now, I understand that some may expect an SNP member here to criticise decisions taken by a Labour Government, but don't just take my word for it. Last month, the Financial Times noted that the UK Government must use the forthcoming UK budget to halt, and I quote, the underinvestment that has resulted in a vicious circle of stagnation and decline, whereby low investment leads to both a weaker economy and greater social and environmental problems, end quote. And this summer, the Institute of Fiscal Studies noted that Labour were being evasive about introducing austerity and stated that a post-election routine of a shock horror at the state of the public finances will not cut it with a new Labour government. Scotland is suffering because of decisions taken by Westminster. To briefly look at the figures, Scotland's block grant is at its lowest share in a decade. Research conducted by the Independent House of Commons Library has shown that Scotland's block grant has fallen as a percentage of UK government spending from just over 8% in 15-16 to 7.6% this year. In basic terms, this means Scotland is receiving less funding from UK spending than at any point in the last decade. The analysis also indicated that Scottish Government's block grant has suffered a real terms cut in every year since 2020, with it currently being worth £6.4 billion less than it was in 2021, a drop of nearly 13%. This comparison before adjustments are made to reflect the recent devolution of tax powers and welfare responsibilities shows the declining spending power of the Scottish Government over time as a result of Westminster cuts. Last year, the Scottish Government's capital block grant was cut by 9.6%, a real terms cut of around £600 million, and it faces a further 3% cut of around £200 million this year. That is a lot of figures, but to put it simply, this means there is less money available to build affordable homes, hospitals, schools, roads and other projects that this country needs. Presiding officer, I want to move to a more positive tone, though, and underline how this SNP government can continue to fight for the people of Scotland on the eve of what is to be a financially very painful UK budget. The budget will undoubtedly mean tough decisions ahead for Scotland. However, this SNP Scottish government will continue to prioritise action to eradicate child poverty, to grasp the opportunities of delivering net zero and to grow the economy by investing in public services and infrastructure. The SNP have a track record of improving lives in challenging circumstances through mitigating actions in an attempt to shield those living in Scotland from Westminster's decisions. The Scottish Government has delivered an expansion of funded childcare, record investment in the NHS, renewable energy development and the introduction of the Scottish Child Payment. Time and time again, even when faced with unprecedented budget constraints, the SNP Scottish Government's aim has been and will continue to be to improve people's lives by focusing on clear priorities that make the biggest difference. So in conclusion, austerity, Brexit, disastrous budgets, cost of living crises and neglecting public services, whether it is Conservative austerity or Labour austerity, Westminster austerity will undoubtedly continue to impact and damage the lives of people in Scotland. There is a better alternative, though, where our public services are supported and where we can ditch the damaging Westminster status quo. And, of course, this is with the full powers of independence. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Ross Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by apologising to Liz Smith, who I believe made some kind remarks about my contribution while I was out of the chamber. I think this has been a really, mostly very enjoyable debate. I think we've unearthed quite a lot of significant issues and areas of consensus that maybe weren't necessarily expected. Katie Clark was absolutely right, though, to say that these issues are not consistently central to our deliberations in this Parliament, or at least they haven't been before now, but hopefully colleagues know me. Despite my Presbyterian demeanour, I am an eternal optimist, so I hope that that change is maybe coming and we can use the final 18 or so months of this parliamentary term to reflect on these major shared challenges. I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment at the start of the debate to commission and produce this five-year fiscal sustainability report and the invitation to other parties to contribute towards that. I do have a couple of questions for the government on that, though. And the first is, why only 5 years? I think there is value in a five-year plan, but the Fiscal Commission quite clearly laid out the much more significant long-term challenges that we have. And I'd also ask if the government could address, in summing up, whether they accept that this is a fundamentally political question. The challenge of what we spend money on is very much for those of us elected to this place. And while an independent report or one delegated to Scottish Government officials would will be of significant value, I'm sure, it is ultimately for politicians to make these significant decisions over tax and spend. I closed my previous contribution by talking about the challenges of the climate crisis and how our fiscal framework isn't going to be able to cope with them. The Fiscal Commission have pointed out we need to spend at least £1.1 billion more annually on climate and nature if we're to be anywhere near on track to meet our ambitions. And Katie Clark, I think, made a very important point that that's not just on preventative spend, for example, to reduce our emissions. Much of the climate catastrophe is now already locked in, and we need to spend significantly on mitigation. The latest flood projections for Greater Glasgow, for example, show that without far more significant spending on flood protection, we're looking at £400 million worth of damage being done annually by the 2040s. So spending now on prevention is essential. Now, for the Greens and for the SNP, I think the way that both of our parties would do at least some of that is by bringing greater borrowing powers to this place. That's certainly one of the areas that we would like to see those greater borrowing powers then used to invest in. The Greens would also, of course, reallocate money away from road expansion projects. I would welcome hearing from colleagues where else in the capital budget they would reallocate from to hit these ambitions. You know, tackling the climate crisis is one area, I think, of shared ambition for us all. There's others like tackling child poverty. I think policy coherence is important there. You know, we can't build far bigger roads and cut emissions, and yet those are consistently part of the same sets of spending plans. At the moment, we have government grants to arms dealers whose missile systems are used to bomb other countries to rubble, and we then use public money to give to the emergency appeals as a result of bombing campaigns caused by the very missile systems manufactured here by companies subsidised by the government. There's no coherence to that. I think we do need a space to discuss and scrutinise long-term spending proposals. That's clearly not the annual budget process, though we do need to improve that, both from the government's perspective but also for Parliament. I don't think, for example, the process we adopted a few years ago of having an afternoon's debate for all committee conveners to share their pre-budget scrutiny reports has had the desired outcome, and we perhaps need to rethink how we make sure that all members, not just those on those committees, are aware of the outcomes of the committee reports. We've got some pretty significant shared ambitions across the Parliament, and I think that the reality is they will require far more spending to achieve them, so we need to be honest about where that's coming from. If I understood Craig Hoy's contribution correctly, though, I think he wants the opposite. He wants to reduce public spending, but he did avoid Daniel Johnson's challenge of identifying where the corresponding cuts would come from. You can't save £1.5 billion a year, the amount raised by the progressive tax differential in Scotland, just from cutting the National Care Service, for example. And I do think that there's a space for tax reform. I'm afraid I do need to disappoint Willie Rennie, although maybe it will reassure him, because there's now going to be a point in this afternoon's debate that we can disagree about. But as much as I do think there's greater room for tax reform, I don't want us to be in a position of changing income tax every year. I'm proud of that £1.5 billion of additional income that we get from tax changes that were proposed and secured by the Greens, but I don't think that we can rely too much on income tax alone. And I think we need to be honest about whether we're getting better, whether we're getting sufficient value from existing areas of spend. I've said before about the small business bonus scheme, and I understand there's an ideological disagreement on that with the Greens on one side and everyone else on the other, so we're never going to win a vote on an issue like that. But the Scottish Government's own review concluded that there was no evidence of positive economic outcomes from that scheme as it's currently designed. That's more than a quarter of £1 billion a year. And I think that goes to Willie Rennie's point around the political challenge in being the one to propose change and having others swing in behind, whether it's vested interest, the status quo, the political opportunity in particular communities. There are difficult areas that we need to address together, even just to explore the issue before we come to different conclusions on it. I think the review of the small business bonus scheme should have resulted in a really fundamental rethink. There is an opportunity for us to, on a cross-party basis, deal with a tricky issue that I think would be much harder for the government to do alone or any individual party to do alone. And that's when, excuse me, that's when we discuss the outcome of the Finance Committee's review of commissioners on Thursday afternoon. I'd like to close, Presiding Officer, with just a couple of additional points of agreement. I agree absolutely with Daniel Johnson that we need to break out of the annual emergency budget review process that we've got ourselves into. That results in incredibly low-value spend. And I agree with the Labour amendment, but I'm afraid the Greens aren't able to vote for it because of what it deletes. If it was adding at the end, we would have been happy to support it. I agree with Liz Smith on the need to regularly review both fiscal frameworks between the UK and Scottish governments. I think it was ridiculous that we spent longer having the two governments agree in terms of reference for that than on the eventual review process, and to review the fiscal framework being developed between Scottish and local government. We should lock in perhaps a 5 or a 10-year review process into that. And of course, I agree on the need for a finance bill. To conclude, I don't think we can wait 18 months to do this again, if for no other reason than we will all be preparing for the election at that point. Plenty of proposals have been put forward to the Scottish Government this afternoon that I hope they'll be able to respond to, not just this afternoon, but in the weeks and months ahead. There's plenty of others, though, that could go into our committee work plans for the remaining stretch before the election. Every committee in this Parliament has a role to play in achieving fiscal sustainability. I think, fundamentally, a lot of what we've been talking about this afternoon is good governance, and I don't think we have these kind of debates enough. This is one of the most substantial that I've taken part in over the last 8 years, and I hope that we'll have the opportunity to follow through on it and prove to the public that we can do the difficult work, in this case, of achieving fiscal sustainability for the public services that we all rely on. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. And this has actually been a fascinating debate this afternoon. And to quote copy one previous member's contribution, I came with one speech and I've now got a completely different one. I did come with a great deal of concern that the reason for this debate, namely the Scottish Fiscal Commission's report back from March 2023, wouldn't actually appear. And I have to say that the Scottish Government's motion laid a certain level of evidence that I was right in thinking that, but I have to say I was wrong, and I have to thank the Cabinet Secretary in her opening speech for actually pointing this debate in the way it should have gone. Of course, one always has to find criticism, so I will climb on the van of it's 18 months too late. I'll climb on the van of the answers with regard to the demographic changes. But I do think there are some things that have been highlighted this afternoon which are incredibly important. The number of suggestions with regard to parliamentary change, the question of the finance bill, allowing a more in-depth analysis, and perhaps to follow on from what Ross Grier has said, it would allow, at least on an annual basis, a genuine part of that process that members, not just on committees, although I do agree that all committees need to do more with regard to the sustainability, but give every member of this chamber a vested interest in it, even if, as Willie suggested, that perhaps it's only money for them that will come through the budget if they argue successfully. We are facing a period of time where the Scottish Government has very, very severe structural challenges, and a number of contributions have talked about the demographic time bomb, maybe debated for decades, but certainly, or maybe not debated enough in the recent past, but certainly one that is there, and I think mention has been made of it. And it will be interesting to see in the five-year plan, where the Cabinet Secretary has talked about the how, not just the why, the how of how this is going to be challenged. Because I think it is of note that although the long-term forecast is for a fall in the population here in Scotland, that's not the same across the whole of the UK. So there are steps that need to be taken to deal with that. And I know that migration and the tailored approach has been raised. But there are other reasons when we look at the ageing demographic to try and seek to facilitate reward and contribution from those who are older and able to do it, and also contribution from those who find themselves with a disability but are still able and indeed in many cases anxious to work, and how that funding relates to the support to allow them to contribute again to the community. And I think, again, to go back to Ross Grier and his first contribution, that reflection that the people of Scotland have to have about what they owe or what their country owes them or what their community owes or how they can contribute. And that engagement is something that I think a lot of individuals in communities are finding a challenge. They're struggling to have their voice heard, and yet the contribution from those with lived experience that we rightly champion in this chamber so frequently often find an inability to share that. And actually, I often find that the answers are out there if we can find a space and a vehicle to allow them to contribute and to allow that discussion about what contribution individuals, companies, businesses, communities should make so that we have a society that we are all, if not absolutely content with, more content with, but also to re-establish that hope that it can be better tomorrow. There's been a lot of discussion about the short-term forecasting and the medium-term forecasting, and I had a whole host of lovely lines of criticism against the Scottish Government, but I'm going to withdraw those because I think there is an understanding across the vast majority of contributions here that actually a five-year plan is a good thing, and I welcome the offer to take contributions from parties across this chamber. But there is something about moving between that 5 and that 50 year where the difficult discussions that have been highlighted have been raised. And if we look at the suggestions about parliamentary change and the responsibility that this parliament has towards it, perhaps there we can start looking at the reach out into our communities to other ways to ask, how do we facilitate this going forward? Because the stark facts that are contained in the Fiscal Commission's report are there to be read, are there to be seen. And, you know, one hopes that some of the further out results that they forecast for 50 years' time can be changed, but can only be changed if we start thinking about this at an earlier stage, i.e. now, even with only 18 months to go. Can I thank the committee, and in particular my colleague Michael Mara, for his contribution, because I think the committee have worked incredibly hard to request this debate and indeed to continue to keep this report on the forefront. Again, I'm slightly cautious of the advert for the debate on Thursday from the committee, but we will get to that when that comes upon us. I wanted to mention Michelle Thompson's contribution, and in particular with regard to the women's budgeting evidence that has been given, because I think there is alternative forms of budgeting we've looked or talked about in various committees and at various stages, human rights budgeting, which perhaps would take some of the sting out of the really difficult decisions that need to be made. And perhaps that is something that can be looked at. There's been a lot of discussion about the need for public sector reform, and the simple phrase public sector reform for most public sector workers immediately raises the loss of job. It's as simple as that. But the delivery of services in a more efficient, more rewarding way to allow more time for those who work with members of the public to in fact have the time to work with them, I think is something that's achievable, and I look forward to the proposals and indeed contributing in due course to how that can happen. But it is something that we need to bring the whole of the country, and in particular COSLA, with us on. And I think we will see some challenges in the very near future as to how the Scottish Government want to approach that with the National Care Service. So in conclusion, I expected the worst, I feared the worst, but actually I found this debate very positive on many different levels. I think the real challenge, though, is what we do next, because we have but 18 months. It's taken 18 months to address this, and I think it's something that the people outside of this place will expect us to do. I'm grateful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Murdo Fraser, a very generous 8 minutes, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, as my colleague Liz Smith noted earlier in the debate, this has been a long time coming. The issues we are discussing are really important, as we've heard throughout what has been a very varied but actually interesting and important debate. And the Finance Committee of this Parliament has to be commended for the work it's done, highlighting concerns around the sustainability of Scotland's financial position. And once again, we're very grateful to the Scottish Fiscal Commission for the work they've done in this area. And it's perhaps disappointing it's taken so long to bring these issues to the Chamber. But that said, the timing of this debate is not unhelpful. We've got a finance-heavy week this week, 3 days of finance debates, one after the other, and finance questions tomorrow on top of it. And of course, we have the significant event that is the UK budget coming tomorrow afternoon, a few weeks before the Scottish budget, which is coming at the beginning of December. So the UK Chancellor and the Finance Secretary here will be very conscious of the issues we've been discussing. There's two fundamental points that should underpin our discussions. I've raised these points in the Chamber many times before, and I make no apology for raising them again. Firstly, there is the block grant from the UK Government, a block grant at record levels. In real terms, it has nearly doubled since the advent of devolution in 1999, even taking account of the additional powers this Parliament has received. So, taking account of inflation, we have more money than ever before. A number of SNP members, Kevin Stewart among them, tried to make the claim that there had been, if I heard him rightly, a £6.4 billion cut in the block grant. A number of members made that. I think Mr Stewart made it most egregiously, as we would expect from Mr Stewart. I would gently say to Mr Stewart, he should read the Fraser of Allender analysis of that claim, which ridicules it as absolute nonsense. And I think he should take time to read that. The second point is the Barnett formula gives us around £2,400 more to spend for every man, woman and child in Scotland than the UK average. Not something we ever hear acknowledged on the SNP benches, but it means that when it comes to services such as health or education or policing, there is much more money to be spent than south of the border. And it leads us to the obvious question. Oh, yes, Mr Mason is sitting on his own, sorry to say.
John Mason.
Thank you. Would you accept that while we may be getting more at the moment, that position is deteriorating because of the fiscal framework is biased against Scotland?
Ardo Fraser.
Well, I'm disappointed in Mr Mason, because I'd hoped in his new liberated position he would have changed his tune a little. I would take a slightly more independent view from his former party. What I would say to him is this. If we're getting 20% more to spend compared to the rest of the UK, you'd expect outcomes in Scotland to be 20% better than the rest of the UK, and that is obviously not the case, particularly in the field of something like education, where our outcomes, sadly, are measurably worse than they are in England, despite the fact that our spend per pupil is much higher. So, against even that background, the fiscal challenges facing the Scottish Government are severe. We see the Finance Secretary already in year having to make savage cuts to budget in order to ensure the books are balanced, and having to raid the ScotWind Fund, a one-off capital windfall of £700 million, every last penny now having to be spent just to fill the gap in current expenditure. Now, hardly a prudent fiscal approach, particularly when we've been lectured to for years by people on the SNP benches about, I will in a second, about how the oil money should have been spent building up a sovereign wealth fund for future generations. Instead, they get the modern-day equivalent of the oil fund, the ScotWind funds. Instead of using that to build for the future, what do? They plug the gap in current expenditure. I'll give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Wind fund is only there because of the actions of this government in creating the conditions to generate the ScotWind monies. The second point is that only £97 million of the ScotWind budget has so far actually been used, and what I have said is very clearly a priority is to drive down the use of ScotWind, which is why I have taken the emergency measures I have taken.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, what the Cabinet Secretary didn't say is all the independent analysis that shows that the money from ScotWind could have been much higher had the Scottish Government driven a harder bargain with the developers, but chose not to. Now, there was various discussions around the demographic issue. We heard that from the Cabinet Secretary, from Daniel Johnson, from Willie Rennie and from others. And these issues are really acute in Scotland because we have an ageing population. We have a low, historically low and falling birth rate, and while our population is still growing, it is only growing because of inward migration into Scotland. And the Cabinet Secretary highlighted figures we saw published recently showing inward migration to Scotland is on the increase. Very welcome figures. They showed that in the 12 months to the middle of 2023, the rate of increase to the Scottish population was 0.8%, and that was very welcome. For the equivalent period, the rate of population increase for the UK as a whole was 1%. So Scotland is 20% behind the rest of the UK when it comes to population growth. And what that tells us is it is not UK immigration policy that is holding back the growth in the Scottish population, because more people are coming into the UK than are coming relatively to Scotland. And the question the Scottish Government therefore have to ask themselves is why is it that so relatively fewer people are choosing to come to Scotland than are settling in other parts of the United Kingdom. The other issue we need to tackle, and again Daniel Johnson referenced this, is broader issues around economic activity, because we have a large percentage of the people in the population of working age who are economically inactive, who could be working and could be part of the working age population but are currently not. Now, some of that is because, for example, they're waiting for operations on the NHS. Some of that around issues, for example, around the disability employment gap that the Economy and Fair Work Committee of this Parliament has just published a report on that I would commend to ministers. So looking ahead, Presiding Officer, we face growing spending challenges, a background of severe cuts to local councils, and, of course, growing costs in the health and social care sector. In addition, spending on social security is expanding rapidly, predicted to rise to £7.8 billion in 3 years' time. So it's no wonder the Fiscal Commission have warned about the sustainability of Scottish finances. So what needs to happen? Well, firstly, we need to see a revisiting of Scottish Government projects. We should start with the National Care Service, a project that now has no support in this chamber, out with the SNP benches, and seems unlikely to proceed any further. That would free up hundreds of millions of pounds that could be spent elsewhere. If I have time, I'll go away. Yeah.
Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, we've had some consensus in this debate today. Mr Fraser's right to point out that parties in this chamber don't favour the National Care Service, but stakeholders out there do. Ms Thompson, in her speech, talked about impediments to women to getting into work because of childcare. That's also an impediment to many women because they're looking after older family members. We have got to fix social care. The National Care Service and its standards is the way that stakeholders want to see that done.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, Mr Stewart says stakeholders want to see this. COSLA doesn't want to see it. Local councils don't want to see it. Trade unions don't want to see it. Do these stakeholders not count to Mr Stewart? Because these are the people expressing very strong views about it. And frankly, we should be spending less money. I've already taken one very lengthy intervention from Mr Stewart. I'm not going to take another one. We should be spending that money on frontline services, not on administration. And, Presiding Officer, we also need to look at the waste in administration in the public sector. So we learned at the weekend, thanks to the Sunday Times, that the number of core staff employed by the Scottish Government has almost doubled in the past decade under the SNP. The civil service headcount has gone up from 5,120 in 2015 to 9,222 in the current year. Now, some of that might be because of additional responsibilities, such as social security, but nevertheless, it's a staggering increase in the number of public employees. If I've time, I'll give way. Yes, of course.
Daniel Johnson.
He mentions that, but I think it's a really good question about why this rise has occurred, especially when actually the rise of Social Security is separate to that 9,000 figure. They are outside the Scottish Government, and that's 4,000 outside that figure. I think, does he agree with me that it's important to understand that distinction?
Murdo Fraser.
Very fair point. And we see, for example, reports about the number of special advisers, number of press advisers in the Scottish Government. But nevertheless, these figures are staggering. And we have this growth in public sector employment, not necessarily doing anything particularly productive on the back of a sluggishly performing private sector economy, meaning the numbers simply don't add up. And we are, of course, seeing concerns that have been highlighted by others in this debate about the tax differential paid by businesses and individuals compared to the rest of the UK and the impact this is having on the ability to attract talent. Little wonder that in a survey published just last week by the Fraser of Allender Institute, just 9% of Scottish firms agree that the Scottish Government understands the business environment in Scotland, compared to 64% who disagree. And just 6% agree that this government engages effectively with their sector, down from 8% in 2023. So much for the New Deal for Business, Presiding Officer. And taxes don't just impact on the private sector. Willie Rennie reminded us of the impact across the public sector. I know personally GPs who now only work 3 or 4 days a week because they regard it as no longer worth their while to work the extra day or two a week because of the amount of money they lose in tax and pension benefits from so doing. So the tax differential is having an impact on the NHS as well. Willie Rennie also referenced, quite rightly, as others did, the need for public sector reform and mentioned the Christie Commission. It's disappointing, as he said, that we're not seeing that being taken forward. So, Presiding Officer, just to reach towards the end of my comment, I'm going for 11 minutes already. That's tremendous. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I could go much longer if you like, because there's lots more I can say. High taxes choke off economic growth. I'm intrigued by Ross Green and the Greens because, you know, every day I read in the papers about more innovative ideas for increasing taxes from the Greens, whether it's taxes on private jets or a so-called mansion tax or taxes on retailers. You know, very interesting ideas. I'd be very intrigued to see whether any of these make it to the budget. But of course, let's remember, the tax burden across the UK is already the highest since the Second World War. I suspect in the UK budget, the Labour budget we're going to see tomorrow, it will rise even further. I'm not sure yet more taxes is the right way to grow, because there's a real danger that high taxes choke off economic growth. In contrast, what we want to see is the tax burden being reduced, an emphasis put on growth as the way to generate the revenues we need to sustain the public services we all depend upon. And in that respect, I agree with Michelle Thompson. I agree with Michelle Thompson. We want to put economic growth first. And I'm glad she's smiling at me from across the chamber. So, Presiding Officer, this has been a very useful debate, but it will only be of significance if the Scottish Government actually listens to the warnings they are hearing. We cannot go on making promises to spend more and more money on new initiatives when that comes at the cost of severe cuts elsewhere. That is the lesson SNP ministers need to take from this debate. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on the Minister to wind up. A very generous 10 minutes. Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I stand to close for this debate on behalf of the Government, and the first of what will be, as has been pointed out by Ross Grier and Murdo Fraser, three debates, a triple header indeed this week, on fiscal aspects of Government policy. So I'm very much looking forward to speaking in all three of these. The tone of the debate today has been largely constructive and consensual, and some interesting ideas. It has had its moments. I'm keen to focus on the positive, but I really have to respond to one or two comments with some on the record, some clarity on the Scottish Government's record in terms of economic performance currently and indeed over a number of years. Of course, lower unemployment in Scotland, the best performing for direct investment outside of London and the South East for 9 years in a row now. Better long-term GDP and productivity growth per head, indeed double the rate of the rest of the UK since 2007. Strong average earnings growth, record income tax receipts, the most generous small business bonus from across the UK, higher small business confidence according to the latest FSB numbers, twice the rate indeed of the rest of the UK. And as Craig Hoy very generously pointed out, I can reinforce the point that Craig Hoy made, that we have more public sector frontline workers, more doctors, more nurses, more teachers, more midwives, considerably more so than in the rest of the UK. Something we're very proud of, and indeed something else we're very proud of is we pay them more. And I'm glad that Craig Hoy made that point for us. Daniel Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
Well, I think the whole chamber thanks the Minister for that long catalogue of numbers. Perhaps a little bit of context. So on foreign direct investment, for example, he's correct about the number of projects, but if you look at the same statistics coming from the ONS in terms of employment and value, we actually fall behind both the North West and the West Midlands. Would he acknowledge that? And secondly, would he acknowledge the point on GDP per head? Well, he may be true, correct, but since 2007, since 2016, which was the point that income tax was baselined, and which is an important point, that GDP per head has grown at 2.6% compared to the UK of 4.4%, which is why we have the performance gap of over £600 million in Scotland. Would you acknowledge those facts and figures?
Minister.
Daniel Johnston still can't resist ignoring the strong performance where it exists of the Scottish economy, and that long term, which is what matters, that long term productivity and GDP growth is what matters. That's what gives us the long term stability in our fiscal situation. That's what gives us the long term ability to deal with those long term trends we're talking about. That's what matters, and that's where the Scottish Government over the last 17 years has delivered for the economy of Scotland and continues to do so. And yes, of course, there are challenges. And this debate is very much about how we face into those challenges. And it's important to recognise those long-term trends on demographics, on technology, on climate, the implications it has for our health service. Those are very absolutely critical to addressing where our economy and indeed our country is going over that, that period of time into the future. It's important to recognise that the sustainability plan sits alongside the medium-term financial strategy. The strategy is what it says on the tin. That's the strategy. The sustainability plan is in order to give us the actions and the specific points that we will deliver on to make that strategy real. And I take Ross Greer's point that 5 years is the time frame that's indicated on the plan, but there will be much in there that gives a longer-term perspective, facing into those very real long-term challenges that that members have highlighted across this debate this afternoon. But of course, we also need to recognise that this government needs to deliver in the short term. We need to deliver that balanced budget every year, something the UK government, of course, doesn't have to do. That, of course, makes those uncertainties that occur through the course of the year have a bigger impact on the Scottish government's budget, with the limited borrowing powers that we have, very limited borrowing powers to be able to flex and deal with those challenges. And that's why it's important to recognise that walking that tightrope, balancing that budget every single year in the face of those uncertainties, while having an eye on the longer-term future, is hugely important and something that this government is absolutely focused on. Turning to some of the, by and large, very thoughtful and considered contributions and very helpful contributions this afternoon, Michael Mara, and I thank the committee for their work in this space, just to give them some confidence that the Talent Attraction Migration Service will be launching in full later this year, and the work of the Population Task Force Minister led continues to be taken forward to address those challenges that we face, that we've talked about in terms of long-term population trends, and the role of the public service reform agenda that I'm taking forward with colleagues is a hugely important part of all of the sustainability work, and I want to come on and give a bit more detail shortly in terms of what we are doing there. As I said, Craig Hoy's contribution talking about positively the work that the Scottish Government has done to increase the number of doctors, nurses, teachers, midwives, etc. across. It's so good I can't help repeating it, and paying them £2,000 more. And if anyone in the rest of the UK is listening that works in any of those professions, you can join many, many, many others and come to Scotland and take advantage of those additional payments, even after tax. Leave you significantly better off, as the Cabinet Secretary pointed out in recent debates. And be part of the influx of people coming from the rest of the UK to live, work and indeed pay taxes in Scotland, as we've seen a net inflow from the rest of the UK over a number of years now across all tax bands. And Craig Hoy made an analogy about changing engine mid-flight. Well, that's exactly what Liz Truss tried to do, and we'll see how that played out. This government isn't making those mistakes that Craig Hoy would want us to make. Dan Johnson's contribution, I thought, was very considered. At one point, he couldn't help blaming the Scottish Government for blaming somebody else. But leaving that to one side, his comments on those long-term trends and the implications for skills retention was hugely pertinent. The role of technology in a role across public services is absolutely critical. And a point I think that Willie Rennie made around about universities plays into this space as well. Scotland has, per head of population, the highest number of top universities of any country in the world, our leading position on technology of the future, underpinned by the work that those universities do. And rest assured, Willie Rennie, that the government works very, very closely with all of our excellent universities in promoting the technology, supporting their entrepreneurial activities, building on the spin-out and start-up businesses, working with them to develop their international footprint and making them more attractive for students to come and contribute to Scotland's economy as a consequence of that, and indeed will continue to do so. I thought that Ross Greer's contribution was perhaps the most interesting, and I don't know what he was drinking when he went to Estonia, but his reflections on that trip have been quite interesting. He's a fan of the big state, and I just want to comment on that. I think that the state needs to be as big as it needs to be in order to deliver what we want it to deliver, but frankly shouldn't be any bigger than that just for the sake of that, and I think is an important point to recognise. But I think, based on his comments, Ross Greer kind of gets that. Welcome his recognition
of the need for efficiency across public services. And I can let him and the Chamber know the Scottish Government will be publishing very shortly some analysis from our work we've done with Scotland's public bodies over the summer, publishing financial data on back office costs and the plans that we have to be able to address that and move more of that resource over time to the front line. I thought the fascinating interaction between Liz Smith, and I hesitate to call it, and Ross Greer, I hesitate to call it a love-in, but there was certainly mutual respect, which is something that we haven't necessarily seen between their two respective parties in the past. And perhaps that's why Liz Smith isn't on the Tory front bench anymore. Both of them... Oh, are you? Oh, right, just not in the finance brief. OK. Well, there you go. Despite your complimentary comments to the Green Party, you're maintaining your position on the front bench, which is very illuminating indeed. And both of them talking about their experiences of Estonia. I've got experience of working, running, managing and investing businesses in Estonia a number of years ago now, and I can bear testament to what we can learn from the way that they approach this, particularly that interaction between use of digital technology and investment in that, but also the work that Ross Greer highlighted of private sector, that crossover between private sector and public sector, something I think I'd like to believe is hugely central to the interaction the Scottish Government has with our business community in Scotland, taking forward our advantages in those high technology sectors. We also highlighted the critical importance of resisting the shift of spend from prevention to managing symptoms, something that is a key pillar of the public service reform work that the government is taking forward. And as I say, there'll be more to come on that in the near future. Other contributors made the point about needing to grow the economy, which is absolutely again central to this government's agenda. One of the First Minister, and the First Minister sitting beside me, one of his imperatives that we do that in order to be able to fund and support in the short term, the medium term, and indeed very importantly in the long term, the public services that we deliver for the people of Scotland. And many members, Fulk McGregor and others, highlighted the importance of tomorrow's UK budget, which will have a real impact on real people's lives in the here and now right across Scotland. The winter fuel payment cut was a tragic mistake on behalf that was made by that UK Labour government. I hope that they've learned from that. We shall find out tomorrow if that is indeed the case, and that doesn't signal the direction of travel and cutting and impacting those that can least afford that. I thought Martin Whitfield and others made a very thoughtful contribution, and I was very taken by his call for how we can harness the talents of all citizens to build a better tomorrow. What a wonderful start line that I'm sure we can all sign up to. And recognise his call and others for the consideration of a finance bill by the Scottish Government, something the Scottish Government is indeed looking at and is happy to work with others to consider if that is indeed a step we want to take and how that would work in practice. Turning to the Public Service Reform Programme, that programme absolutely building on Christie, working to make the Christie principles real, focusing on efficient and effective delivery of services and making sure that we spend those resources as efficiently and effectively as possible, looking at the most effective landscape for doing so, and the Finance Committee's Commissioner debate on Thursday gives us an opportunity to explore that aspect in more detail, and I very much look forward to that. And also, as I said, that very important focus on shifting resources to preventative spend and resisting the temptation to focus on the here and now exclusively. So, important to recognise, of course, that UK budget is tomorrow. Members across the Chamber have highlighted the need for increased investment in our national infrastructure to underpin further productivity growth to support services in the future. But I have to remind members that we're facing a forecast real terms cut in our capital block grant totaling £1.3 billion between 2023-24 and 2027-28. And at the same time, high inflation has, of course, pushed up construction costs. I hope the members will join with me in calling on the Chancellor to reverse this forecast cut and provide additional funding to invest in the infrastructure needed to grow our economy. This government has consistently called on the new UK government to remove the damaging two-child limit, benefits cap and bedroom tax, something that we have spent £134 million this year alone mitigating those damaging welfare policies put in place by the previous Conservative UK government, money that could have been invested in other priorities. And I hope, again, members will join with this government in calling on the Chancellor to abandon the policies of the previous UK government and work with us to deliver a fairer system. The Chancellor has made clear her ambition to grow the economy, but it's important that she works with the devolved governments to do that. And driving economic growth is, of course, a key priority for the Scottish Government, even more important given that Brexit has been estimated to have left the UK economy at least £69 billion worse off compared with UK membership, something the Labour Party are strangely silent on. Matter of fact, if you take the black hole that we all knew about during the election campaign that they denied existed and the other black hole that they've apparently found since they've took office, add them together, that £42 billion is still less than the annual loss of public sector revenues as a consequence of this misguided decision to leave the European Union. So the sooner the Labour Party comes to its senses on that and takes steps to work to reverse that tragic decision, the better it will be for the UK and of course, for Scotland. So in closing, Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary said in her opening speech that fiscal sustainability has been and will continue to be a key priority for this government. The Scottish Government has been upfront and transparent about the fiscal challenges we face on the path to improve stability of the public finances. The five-year, indeed longer, sustainability delivery plan will put into action the strategic direction offered by the medium-term financial strategy. And this will be a crucial step on the path to delivering the First Minister's priorities, eradicating child poverty, something made strides on with the Scottish Child Payment, something that doesn't happen anywhere else in the UK, raising living standards by growing the economy, protecting the planet through our just transition to net zero, and improving public services by delivering on that the public service reform agenda. Tomorrow, the Chancellor will have the opportunity to also commit to these priorities and to take decisions in Scotland's medium and long-term interests. The Chancellor can choose to follow the tired playbook of previous UK governments, cuts to spending, low investment and no long-term ambition, or the Chancellor can chart a new course, one that promotes investment, looks at the long-term and works with, not against, devolved governments. And urge members this afternoon to support the motion from the Government in front of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on fiscal sustainability. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. And I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Craig Hoy is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Daniel Johnson will fall. And the first question is that amendment 15048.2 in the name of Craig Hoy, which seeks to amend motion 15048 in the name of Shona Robison on fiscal sustainability, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. Therefore, we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.